Good morning. Or actually, it's afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone. We are going to get started promptly at 12 p.m. I am State Senator Zellnor, Myrie, and I'd like to welcome everyone to the Senate Elections Committee public hearing on voting rights and the administration of our elections. I would first like to start with a very, very huge thank you to the Monroe County Legislature for allowing us to use their chamber this morning. We are grateful that you have allowed the Senate to conduct this hearing to solicit feedback from voters and stakeholders who are directly impacted by the administration of our elections. Now, we have held a series of hearings. This is the third hearing that we've held statewide on this topic. I want to thank our Majority Leader, Senator Andrea Stewart Cousins, for her leadership and commitment to our democracy and ensuring that we hear from people who are directly impacted. The reason that we're here is simple, and the voting rights are the rights that protect every single other right. It is preservative of the rights that we hold dear. And what we have seen across the country, and unfortunately here in New York, is that the franchise has been restricted. It has not been easy to access, and there have been a number of challenges that prevent every New Yorker from having a world-class democracy. It is our job as members of the Elections Committee and as members of the New York State Senate to ensure that we deliver that world-class democracy. And that requires us to hear from voters, requires us to hear from boards of elections and many other stakeholders to see how we can improve New York's voter participation rates and the challenges that we've seen in the administration of our elections. My mantra has been to take New York from worst to first, and I believe we are well on our way in that journey. And I will also like to extend a huge, huge thanks to my colleagues who have joined us today. We are, of course, joined by the hometown hero, a member of the Elections Committee who has hit the ground running in her first year here in the Senate, someone who I'm very proud to serve with and who I think is doing an excellent job. So I'm going to offer her the opportunity to give some opening remarks. Without further ado, Senator Samra Brook.
Thank you so much, Senator, and good afternoon, everyone. Thank you to our chairperson of the Elections Committee for understanding the importance of having Rochester's voice and our greater Rochester region's voice as a part of this overall elections tour. You know, we often talk about here in our region the need to have a voice at the table. I think for a very long time, many of us here have felt a little left out when it came to legislation in Albany. And so, as Senator Myrie pointed out, we've been fighting to get more attention to our region. And a huge part of that is bringing our colleagues here to hear directly from you. I do my best work in our conference sharing your stories and your values, but the truth is nothing is more powerful than hearing from the people who are most affected by these voting reforms and by these election laws, and those people who are poll workers, board of elections, the people administering our local elections. So I know it's the middle of the day on a beautiful August day, and I don't know if you know this, Senator Myrie, we only got a few months of really beautiful weather in Rochester. So for folks to spend hours of their day with us today really shows your commitment to the democratic process. And I'll reiterate how important it is that we do put forward reforms to our election process, to our democratic process, and that that is informed by the public. While other states are going backwards in terms of suppressing voters and making it harder to vote, New York is moving forward. And so I want to continue to see us lead, and I have to commend our chairperson, Senator Myrie, from the moment he stepped in a couple years before me. He has truly been a leader alongside our Majority Leader, Andrea Stewart Cousins, to make sure New York is always leading the way with elections and voting. So thank you all for coming, and I'm looking forward to hearing your testimony.
Thank you very much, Senator Brook, and I will underscore that she's done a phenomenal job. I did not know she had the ability to legislate the weather such that we would have such a beautiful day, but I'm grateful for that. We've also been joined today by the ranking minority member on the Elections Committee, Senator Ed Rath, who was with us yesterday in Syracuse. We have been, unfortunately, in this country in a very partisan climate as it pertains to access to the ballot. But what one of the things that I pride our state Senate on is that we can tackle issues in a bipartisan fashion, and that we may have disagreements, but we are not disagreeable. And so I'm grateful to be joined today by Senator Ed Rath, and I will give him an opportunity to bring us remarks.
Well, thank you so much, Chairman Myrie, and to Senator Brook. It is wonderful to be here in the Flower City for this hearing today. And if I could challenge you a little bit, Senator Brook, the sun is always shining in Rochester. That's why it's a Flower City, right? But ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to be here and to participate in this critically important discussion that we are going to have on voting rights as well as administration of elections today. And we heard yesterday firsthand from a diverse and a broad spectrum of individuals and organizations with regards to the challenges in New York State when it comes to the administration of elections. And I look forward to hearing the perspective of the folks who are here today as well. I am proud to serve the 61st Senate District, which does include a portion of the city of Rochester, as well as two towns within Monroe County, as well as Genesee County and Erie County. So within the region, I'm very happy to be here. And I'll tell you this, ladies and gentlemen, and this is so very important to everyone who's testifying today. The only way that we can be effective as senators is by hearing from you all. And it doesn't matter if it's an elections issue or any other issue that we are working on as your state senators, your perspective provides us something to learn about, something to understand, and something to apply in the work that we do. And if we're effective senators, it's because we're listening and we're learning and we're doing our due diligence. And that's a part of what we're doing across the state, is our due diligence with regards to the administration of our elections. Because to Senator and Chairman Myrie's point, the franchise and guaranteeing the franchise and the right to vote for the residents of New York State is critically important. And we are all focused on working on this together. We may have different perspectives, but I firmly believe that reasonable people with reasonable ideas can come to reasonable solutions. And I'm here today to listen to you all and then to take the pages of notes, which we all take, as action items for a roadmap for the work that we're gonna do as your senators. So again, it's my honor to be here. Look forward to hearing from you. And Chairman Myrie, we'll continue to take this show on the road going forward.
Thank you very much, Senator Rath. A few programming notes before we commence with the first panel. First, it is the policy of the Monroe County Legislature that everyone be masked if they are inside the chamber, unless you are testifying and speaking on the mic. So I would remind folks that that is a requirement to continue to be present here in the chamber. And I will also remind our witnesses that you have 5 minutes each to testify. That will be followed by 3 minutes allotted to each member to question or to make comments on the testimony that came before this committee. So without further ado, let me thank my staff who made all of this possible. Edleen and Matt, I want to thank the staffs of Senator Brook and Senator Rath for all of their work on this. Thank you to the Senate staff, Chris and Liz, who were helpful. And I think it's important that we shout out our tech staff who, you know, there are thousands of viewers watching this at home, I'm sure. It would not be possible without our tech staff, Pete Dudley, James Soddle, and Lexington Fields. So the first panel that is going to be before us today will be Dr. Justin Young and Reverend Patrina Freeman. Please make your way up to the panel. Mr. Young, whenever you're ready.
the...
The microphone.
Can you hear me? I'm not sure where the mic is.
Oh, there we go. Good morning. Thank you for this opportunity to speak before the Senate Committee on Elections. I am Dr. Justin Young. I serve as the treasurer of the National Federation of the Blind of New York State. I also serve as their legislative director. I'm here to talk about the issues that blind voters have had or face in New York State. The election process is not easy for us as blind voters. We, as the chairperson said, would like the opportunity to vote privately and independently. Unfortunately, it's not that way at this time for blind voters. It is because the process involves paper forms that are not accessible using screen reading software for blind people, because often they are scanned pictures or PDFs that can't be fillable on computers. They also have, at the polling places, ballot marking devices, which are at times not taught to the poll workers how to properly use. Some poll workers treat them as coat racks and leave them in the closets that don't even know where they are. This prevents blind voters from accessing their right to vote. Also, for these machines, it has different sized ballots, which if you're in a small county and there's very few blind voters, the anonymity is not guaranteed. We also would appreciate if the Senate and Assembly would consider introducing what's called an accessible electronic ballot delivery system, which essentially allows blind people to cast their ballots using a computer. And we'd also appreciate if the legislature would consider electronic return. Currently in Monroe County and in New York State, last year they they instituted a temporary process where you can use fillable PDF files, which didn't really work that well, but you had to keep printing them out. If you don't have access to a printer, you don't have access to a vote. It's in our perspective. So we'd appreciate if consideration of electronic return also would be implemented with these accessible electronic ballot delivery systems. I want to make it clear that we are not advocating for online voting. We're advocating for the use of software which would be secured using security mechanisms. And other states do have these similar platforms. So we want to make sure that blind voters and voters who have print disabilities can vote privately, securely, and make sure that their voices are being heard, just like every other voter in New York State. Thank you, and I look forward to taking any questions.
Thank you. Reverend Freeman, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Senator, for giving me that little upbraid. Good morning. My name is Reverend Patrina Freeman. I am chairperson of Irondequoit Commission Advancing Racial Equity, or ICARE, and am a sitting member of the Irondequoit Town Board. The right to vote in America is once more under severe assault, propelled by a toxic political environment of hyper-partisan politics, baseless claims of voter fraud, and a wildfire of social media disinformation campaigns. State houses across this country now face a flood of legislation aimed to strategically disenfranchise millions of voters. And that is especially true for those who look like me, who are black and brown. In the face of such systematic anti-voting actions, those of us who believe in expanding the franchise of voting to include all Americans, no matter their race, political affiliation, age, religion, and income status and cultural identity, must courageously stand up and get into good trouble to safeguard the right to vote for all. So my purpose today is to simply bear witness to that. Today, I recommend two actions that the Board of Elections can take while greatly increasing both access to and participation in the voting process in New York. My first recommendation is that the BOD increase voter access to early voting. As the lives of New Yorkers become more varied, so too should the access to the ballot box. Gone are the days of confining voters to a single 8 to 12 hour period. Instead, measures like a robust early voting program can greatly increase voter turnout and has done so across the nation. While I commend New York State for offering early voting beginning in 2019, data from that same election year reveals that much more work needs to be done if the state is going to adequately meet voters' polling needs. For example, statewide data from the 2019 election reveals that the biggest group that took advantage of early voters were those aged 65 and over because they have the free time. And in Monroe County, that they made up 48% of all early voters. However, the largest group that vote in New York State, who are registered to vote in New York State, are between the ages of 18 and 34. And in Monroe County, they only made up 8% of the vote, while they constitute 24% of all of the county voters. Drilling down further, when I asked people on the BOE staff why this disparity, they explained to me very clearly that it is because of the lack of diversity and convenient polling places for early voting where young people frequent as a culprit. Let me share just one story. There's a student, I will call her name Lisa. She has for the past 2 years tried to get early voting at her private college with no success. When I talked to other young voters, both locally and across the state, they mentioned a similar thing. While this dilemma is very frustrating and heartbreaking, it already has a ready solution. Imagine if we would offer and enlist early voting at colleges and universities throughout the state. The impact for such a measure would be immediate and life-changing, both for students, those who love and support them, and for those of us who are in favor of fair and free elections. I'm noticing that my time is getting short, so I am going to jump to my second one. My second recommendation is for the Board of Elections to implement online voting registration in New York. The current voting registration process is rather tedious. In fact, it's downright archaic in today's tech-savvy world. Yet this is another barrier for New York voters to overcome. I'm aware that we have the DMV can offer electronic voter registration, and that some have voted that way, but it is it's not vast enough. And so I would urge this committee to consider offering that online voting to everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to testify, and thank you for taking the time out to hold and convene this commission.
Thank you.
Sure.
Senator Brook.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Young and Reverend Freeman, for joining us today and for all of the advocacy that you bring with this work you're doing. I had a quick question for you, Dr. Young, just a clarification. What you bring up is something that our staff has also heard from folks who have been trying to vote. And I was wondering, we know that there's an election hotline numbers that the general public can call an issue. Is there anything specifically, if you were to come into a polling location and run into an issue specifically about your ability to vote and the accessibility around that, is there a place you can call or a trusted part of the administration that you all have specifically for that?
I don't know if there's a specific phone number for that, but part of the hotlines that are set up in theory would have a built-in component of that. If they don't, they really should have the dedicated ADA coordinator on hand so they can make sure that the ballot machines are working, that they know how to get them to work, that staff or poll workers are trained properly, which is something I forgot to mention, is that there needs to be more training for the poll workers as opposed to just a day long thing. It is my understanding that there's not much training on the actual accessibility features for voting, and I think that needs to be increased more so, especially as it relates to the multiple accessible features that voting has. I only mentioned the accessible ballot marking devices. There's many others for multiple disabilities, depending on what your disability is, that quite frankly, I don't believe poll workers, and I've heard many stories in Monroe County that poll workers are just, they don't even know what they are. So I think the more, if the more increase the Board of Elections can have as it relates to accessibility, training, advocate organizations, collaboration between organizations like the NFB for Linus, for example, would be critical.
Thank you.
Senator Rath?
Thank you, Chairman Myrie. And my first question is also to Dr. Young. And first of all, I want to thank you for your advocacy and your leadership. It's very important that we hear from folks like yourself who are out front working very hard, and I appreciate everything that you're doing with regards to that. You were talking about the ADA coordinator, the dedicated ADA coordinator, and the lack of training. And we heard about this yesterday, as a matter of fact, with regards to ADA accessibility. And this is something that we are going to be paying very close attention to with regards to the training for the ADA coordinators, as well as all poll workers, that they have the proper access to training, so that the challenges that you're faced with hopefully don't continue when you're trying to go to vote. But I wanted to ask you about your comment you made, which caught my interest, about the use of software for voting for the blind in other states. And you had mentioned that that is being used in other states. Do you have any more information about that? Because that seems very interesting to me as to what's happening in other areas. And we don't need to reinvent the wheel. Maybe we just need to build a better wheel, per se. And let's see if we can work on what's being successful in other states. Can you expand on that a little bit?
Sure. So one example would be the state of Maryland, who was the first to use an accessible electronic ballot delivery system. I believe that was first used in the 2016, 2017, and 2018 elections, which the National Federation of the Blind was very involved with. Our national headquartered office is in Baltimore, and the staff and members of the Maryland affiliates, which we have affiliates in every state, the District of Columbia and Puerto Rico. So the Maryland affiliate was very instrumental in getting that done. Also, states like Colorado and Hawaii have passed legislation, I don't know if their governors have signed it yet, related to accessible voting, electronic return, accessible ballot delivery systems. So those are three examples that I know of off the top of my head.
Thank you. It's very helpful.
Of course.
Thank you. So I have a question for Reverend Freeman, partially a clarifying question. The latter part of your testimony talked about online voter registration.
Yes.
I just wanted to clarify that you were talking about online voter registration and not online voting.
Voting registration.
Okay, great. I think we have taken some steps in that direction in the legislature. We passed that in 2019 with an implementation aimed to begin next year. But I think it's important to have the voices of voters like yourself to make sure that that system is accessible, that it makes sense, that it's not cumbersome, yes, as what we are experiencing now to some degree with the DMV. So I appreciate that testimony. And Dr. Young, if you could just on this returning electronically the ballot, can you talk a little bit more about why that does not pose a security threat?
Well, I want to begin by saying I'm not a security expert, but from what I understand is that there are mechanisms in place for the companies that offer this service. Democracy Live! Is one that I've heard of. that does permit this. My understanding is that it is very secured. It is done as their advocacy is growing. Other states, counties are considering it, looking at it. Also, the military uses electronic return, is my understanding. So there are secure mechanisms involved with it, but beyond that, I'm not really sure.
Thank you, and I appreciate that answer. Thank you both for your time and for your testimony.
Thank you very much.
Next, coming to the stage, and if I call out your name on a panel, please make your way up, even if all of the members of that panel are not present. So for panel two, it is Preston Faulkner, Judith Hunter, and Robert Schwarting. Mr. Faulkner, okay. Whenever you're ready.
Okay. My name is Preston Faulkner. I'm a resident of Rochester, New York. I grew up in a rural town in Allegheny County in a blue-collar, working-class military family. My family never voted or talked about voting or civic engagement. It wasn't until well after college that a friend expressed his surprise that I was not registered and had never voted. But even after I did register and started to vote, I was not engaged. For most elections, I would simply ask him to put together a list of who I should vote for, and I was always waiting until the last minute and may have missed a few elections because of that. Unfortunately, it took a dark and dangerous period in our democracy's history to jolt me out of all of those years of what I think was civic laziness. I remember one day last summer, pulling into my carport filled with more despair than ever before in my life, the seemingly endless barrage of hateful, derisive, and divisive rhetoric at the highest levels of our government seemed only to get worse each day. And just when we needed the exact opposite, when we needed leadership to bring the country together against a global pandemic and extraordinary social unrest. I needed to do something with all this anxiety, something that would work toward restoring respect for the foundations of our democracy that were being trampled upon. I realized at that moment that I needed to become politically active. I share this background because it was the journey that followed that made me finally understand the true wisdom of Frederick Douglass, how he upheld voting as the most sacred right of all. My political activism as a campaign volunteer over the past year afforded the privilege of talking with hundreds of voters in Rochester, New York, as well as with hundreds, if not thousands, of voters in no fewer than six states, other states, including North Carolina, Florida, Michigan, and Arizona. It wasn't until I had the opportunity to speak with such a broad range of voters that I realized how consequential every step of the voting process can be for a legitimate vote to actually make it into the system and hopefully not get wrongfully thrown out or disqualified along the way. From registering to actually casting a ballot, to varying degrees, it can seem like an Olympic event, particularly when compared to the simplicity of a country like Sweden that has features like automatic registration, and not surprisingly, an average turnout of over 83% compared to the US average of about 54%. Two stories that stick in my mind include a conversation with a former felon in Florida who didn't think he had the right to vote. In fact, he did have the right to register and to vote, and we did our best to get the information to him, though time was running very short and it seemed unlikely his vote would be cast. This was in late October, in the days leading up to the most important election in my lifetime. The other involved an elderly Rochester woman who needed to rely on family members who would hopefully be able to provide transportation on primary election day earlier this summer. She was not comfortable asking busy family members to make the alternative arrangements so that she could vote early. I asked her if she was sure that she would have a ride on election day. Even though she expected that she would, I sensed that the schedules of the family members were complicated based on work and other demands, and that if something did go awry on Election Day, that her vote would likely not make it to the ballot box. My impressions from these two experiences alone caused me to be very disappointed and really saddened that our nation is not the leader it should be in the world in voting access and engagement. By the same token, I feel that New York State should be leading the way in our nation, demonstrating exemplary practices from start to finish. I agree with my state senator, Sam Brook, whose comments I appreciated on the radio the other day. As much as I love Colorado, Hawaii, and Oregon, and every other state that seems to have jumped ahead of New York State in terms of sensible voter-centered practices, I bristle at the fact that those states are looking at New York State in the rearview mirror when it should be the other way around. New York, we've got decades on these other states, and I think it's time to act our age as a senior state and set the standards for democratic-centered election practices for the nation to follow. Voting should be the least encumbered civic responsibility we undertake, and our election laws should support this across the board. If you're eligible and want to vote, it should not be an Olympic event. It should be one of the easiest things to do. Voters should be instead spending their time learning about candidates and issues and not sorting out confusing processes to actually cast the ballot. And I have 15 seconds, so I just had four ideas. These aren't new, but I just had to throw them out. Establish Election Day as a national holiday. I know we can't do this in New York. To improve access broadly as an alternative to a holiday, an election weekend, early voting on Saturday, and Election Day on Sunday. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Hunter.
Hello, any chance you can hear me with my mask on?
We can.
Oh, okay, very good. I'm an immunocompromised individual, and it can be very awkward to take off a heavy-duty mask. Thank you for holding this hearing. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak. I really commend you for going to all regions of the state of something that is so important as elections, of course, is going to affect everyone. And it is very admirable that you're doing this work. I also commend you for the many election reforms that have happened in the last few years. They've been a great improvement in the state of New York, and I know there are more in the pipeline, and that is something I am also grateful for. My name is Judith Hunter, and I'm the chair of the Democratic Rural Conference of New York State. We represent 47 counties, those that have fewer than 250,000 people. Genesee County, which you mentioned, Senator Rath, and Ontario County, which I know you, Senator Brook, represent in part, are both part of what we shorthand as the DRC. 47 of New York's 62 counties. And if we are going to be talking about something that will have such a profound impact on the administration of elections, we need to remember that there are 47 county boards of elections in small counties. And they function differently from what happens in the big counties. And we really need to take care that we don't go with a one-size-fits-all kind of set of reforms. Obviously, there are many useful reforms that can be made. One thing that I see throughout these 47 counties is a huge range of setups of offices. You have some counties which have part-time commissioners, maybe they have full-time clerks or full-time deputies. There is this range. And that goes back to how the counties have set them up. And unfortunately, I think that counties have an incentive to try to go cheaply with election administration, and that can be a real problem for their citizens, particularly in a situation like last year when so many adjustments had to be made on the fly. I absolutely commend everyone involved in last year's election and setting the procedures for last year's elections for their competence and their flexibility in dealing with the situation. But it was very hard on boards. So setting some kind of regularized standard for staffing and funding based on population would be a very good thing. But I want to stress something as my most important point, which is that I know that many people have spoken about the role of political parties in staffing election boards. The thing is, particularly in rural counties, if you did not have a mandated bipartisan personnel structure, you would in fact have a partisan one. And whatever party dominated in that county would be able to appoint the personnel, and you would not have the built-in checks and balances that the mirrored system of the two main parties checking each other, making sure that the processes are fair and equitable ensures. So there are many reforms that could be made, but this is one of those instances where you might be throwing the baby out with the bathwater, and it could really damage rural counties. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hunter. And next is Mr. Schwartz.
I would like to thank you for allowing me to speak. I have long looked forward to being able to influence election law, especially as it affects small rural counties. Yates County is a population of approximately 25,000 persons, a large proportion of whom are Mennonites who do not vote. And we have about 14,600 registered voters. I've been involved in elections as a voter for 54 years. I know I don't look that old. Inspector for 34 years in Yates and Tompkins County. And I've been a deputy commissioner for 3 years, and now I am serving as the commissioner, one of the two commissioners. I am the Republican commissioner for the county. I strongly support bipartisan elections, as was testified yesterday and as we heard again today. It works extremely well in our county. We have divisions of duties, and we call it checks and balances. It works very well when we're accessioning or purging or trying to support voters. Anybody coming in the front door is met by anybody. We take care of all candidates equally, both sides of the office. Unlike some other situations I've heard, we are probably a great example of things working. And we have to, because we don't have a big budget. One size does not fit all. We've heard that several times. And I'm going to address specifically early voting in these remarks. We've since been able to bring early voting in and run it out of the Board of Elections, but we still have to fund the weekends and the evenings. My point is that there were 46 voters in 66 hours in the last primary. It was atrocious. It was horribly expensive. We had no nighttime voters, and even in the presidential year last year, we had very, very few nighttime voters. Our turnout in 20, let me make the point. Early voting has not expanded participation. It's only shifted it slightly. Our turnout in 2020 was extremely manageable in all polling sites. We had one polling site that had a waiting line of about 15 minutes. The rest were very smooth, and there were even periods of time when no one was voting. And that was also true of early voting. We had a slug at the beginning, like an egg going through a snake. One party had a political rally outside the front door, and it took us most of the morning to get them to work through the system. That's the only time we had bad lines. Thank you for the grants. that you've given us for cybersecurity, technology, and the support of the COVID emergency operations. It was extremely well appreciated. We had to go out and get another grant from Bill Gates's foundation, and that helped us, and we managed to make it through without putting too much of a burden on the county. We had to throw away reprinted ballots and envelopes and things that had to change because of the governor's executive orders. I would caution you, as you're adopting laws, to please, please work hand in hand with the State Board of Elections and with your election commissioners. We see down the road the impact of your changing legislation. For example, we have to replace machinery. It's not cheap. If we make a bunch of purchases now with the understanding that we're going to have a minimal absentee ballot counting, and there's still going to be Election Day counting, we have to support the Election Day because that's where the majority of our votes come in. If you're going to change or shift something that upsets that balance, we're now going to have a lot of capital that's been invested, and it's no good. So my county is very tight with capital investments, and they want to know where law is going. BMD training is done usually in our county in 4-hour period so that we have one fully trained, competent inspector at each polling site for 17 hours who knows how to make the sip and puff work, how to make sure that all of the names that are on the ballot were correctly coded so that they could be understood. They, in fact, have voted the entire sequence of candidates and all of the perceived possible combinations, overvotes, undervotes. And so they know how that machine works for an individual with needs. We do that in a 4-hour period. At the same time, we're testing our ballots. It's not a big expense. Lastly, I have many, many more comments to pass on to you. I think yesterday I wrote about 6 pages. I will submit them to you later.
Thank you very much. Senator Brooke.
Yes, thank you all so much. You covered so much ground in one panel, and we really appreciate the thoughtfulness with which you're coming to these issues. A quick comment and then two rather quick questions. Mr. Faulkner, I appreciate what you talked about in terms of reinstating voting rights and making that very clear to folks. I can share with you that just a couple years ago, well, not a couple years ago, last year, I had a conversation with someone similarly, and they told me, well, I'll never be able to vote again. And I got to let them know that actually you will be able to vote. And you know, this year we were able to finally pass the law in New York State that allows people who have served their time who are out on parole to get a timely restoration of their voting rights, which obviously is a huge step forward. So I do agree with you that there is much more education to be done to make sure that we actually are re-enfranchising those folks, and that they actually go out and exercise the right to vote. The question I had is to my two rural representatives here. You know, I hear what you're saying about bipartisan elections, right, and how it's much different up where we live than perhaps in places where there's more one-party rule. But one thing I wanted to drill down, and maybe Ms. Hunter, you didn't bring this up, but if you could add to some of what the other testimony was around early voting, and you know, we saw that it did increase rates of voting in other places, and I'm curious if you believe there are tweaks or changes, or perhaps if you want to to make it more effective for Yates County, and then perhaps Ms. Hunter, if you want to quickly add in what the maybe larger experience is for some of the other rural counties.
Well, I would say that even within the rural counties, there is a great range. You're from Yates County, which is extremely small. I'm from Livingston County, which is less small. And I stood out in the drizzle for multiple hours waiting to get into our county government center to cast my ballot early. It was exacerbated by a security bottleneck in the building, but still there were many, many people exercising the franchise early. And I think you will find that experience is varied. Each county is different. Each county has a different process, different availability. So again, I think you're going to find a spectrum.
I cannot speak for all of the other rural counties, some of which are larger, but I have seen some of the statistics on the turnout for early voting in the last primary. It was not good. It seems to me that we need the right to manage early voting according to our past history. We know very well what we're going to get. For the presidential election, we got 20% voted early. We had them come in the building, we bypassed security. We set up special procedures to make the wait inside comfortable, and we allocated 4 machines to early voting, and sometimes we only used 1. But during high periods, we could move them through. We could probably move 2 voters through per minute using electronic poll books and on-demand printers. Now, I think it's going to be hard for you to structure something that says populations less than 250,000 has the opportunity to do this, 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 and this differently. But I wish you would look at that. It would be helpful for us. For example, we find no value in nighttime early voting. And now as you begin to consider absentee ballots being issued on the Monday before election, early voting going on right up until, in our case, 3 p.m. on Sunday. If you enlarge the hours, it'll be 6 p.m. on Sundays. We have 2 shifts that come in at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the afternoon. They work till midnight, and then there's another shift that comes in at midnight and works the next morning, just so we can get the emergency poll books printed and we can get the electronic poll books updated. If you push more stuff into that 1 week period of early voting, absentee ballot counting, last minute registration and voting, you're taxing a small system to the extreme. Now, we plan on having people on standby. We plan on having 2 shifts, but my legislators who are penny pinchers ask, What are you doing here? And frankly, I blame you guys. So hope you got broad shoulders.
Thank you.
We appreciate that. Senator Rath.
Thank you, Chairman Myrie. And I appreciate the comments and the testimony of all 3 of you. Again, this is perspective that we need to hear. And I have a number of questions. First is for Ms. Hunter. And I have to share with you very much so that one size does not fit all in New York State. And the challenges of our rural and our agricultural counties versus our suburban and urban counties for elections and the administration of elections is very, very different. And we've seen this in many, many cases and challenges that if it's funding issues, if it is access to training, if it's access to individuals, rural counties and agricultural counties have a huge challenge different than others. So you had mentioned that counties, rural and agricultural counties have an incentive to go cheaply, per se. And I want to ask if you could expand on that, but also mention that New York State set aside $25 million in this budget this year for the administration of elections, which was woefully inadequate. And many rural counties and agricultural counties received $20,000, $25,000 to meet the needs of all these changes to the election law. So could you talk a little bit more about how counties are incentivized to cut corners and save money or spend less money, per se?
Well, I think all county governments seek to tax people as little as they can. And it's hard when they see an office that they associate with one day of the year to devote great resources to it, but of course their work is ongoing all year long and is of the greatest value, you could argue. But I know in my own county they had to resort to getting outside grants. They got a big grant from the Zuckerberg Foundation, which allowed them to adjust and make the kind of changes they needed to. But without that grant, they would have been in real straits. So it's not something I think counties do deliberately, but particularly when you're having to be proactive and flexible about a public health emergency, you know, this is just something that was new for everyone, and it was a real challenge.
Thank you, and I'll keep this next question very, very brief, but it is for Commissioner Schwerting. With regards to early voting locations, I know that sometimes people have to travel a long ways to go to early vote, sometimes an hour in each direction. And that can be very, very difficult for early voting locations to meet the needs of a community. And I like the idea of potentially having something for smaller counties with regards to early voting access versus urban counties where it's very different. How many early voting sites are there in the two counties, Yates and Tompkins, that you?
I can't speak for Tompkins because early voting, I didn't participate in it there. We have one site in Yates County at the county office building in the BOE office. If it's a large election, we kick the clerk out of her conference room and we take over that whole corridor and the conference space down there. The maximum distance right now is 21 miles. We did a GIS analysis of how we can improve early voting participation. And one of the ideas that we surfaced was to have three regional polling sites for 2 or 3 days staffed. And so in that case, the maximum distance would be about 7.5 miles. But we need the flexibility to mm-hmm. start thinking of things like that. We cannot have three polling sites if we have to staff each one for 66 hours, or in the case of 70.
See, I find that very interesting to strategically have polling sites maybe dotted around the county at different times to make it easier for people and to provide better access. So I like that idea.
We have three villages, which are population sites, and then we have the fourth major village, which is the county seat. So we opted to do it at the county seat. Election law says we should do that, so that's what we did. But if you can give us some flexibility, we can reach out to the voters better when we know they're going to be moving around. These are farmers, lake dwellers, and vineyardists.
Thank you.
If I could add, Livingston County also only had one site at the County Government Center.
Thank you, Senator Rath, and for your responses. So my question is directed at Ms. Hunter and Mr. Schwerting. The notion of ridding ourselves of the bipartisan structure of the boards is something that is a live discussion, and both of you have expressed your support for maintaining what we have. I'm wondering if you can respond to the questions of the influence of partisan control over hiring and training and competence at these boards. I think for those who believe that we have to get rid of the partisan structure, they believe that the partisan nature of the appointments of employees allows for incompetence to continue. And I'm wondering if you can speak to or respond to that.
Something I would begin with is by pointing out that party leaders are elected officials. We are subject to primary, you know, we go through the petitioning process, and we are accountable every 2 years. But the other thing I would add is that it's not simply our decision. Several years ago, the Board of Supervisors in my county rejected our unanimous recommendation of the committee because they wanted to completely revamp things. And unfortunately, the Democratic commissioner was the one who was up for reappointment first. That was a terrible situation for us, but it shows that it was not a unilateral decision on our part. I would remind you, the committee, that just this year in Chautauqua County, there was a situation where the party's selection was not approved by the county legislature. And it's I think, tempting to think that we're just putting cronies in there. But A, we're not putting them in. like I'm saying, there are definitely checks on that. But also, it's in our interest to appoint competent people. We don't want problems at the Board of Elections. We absolutely need them to run correctly. And one reform that I would certainly get behind is extensive training for new commissioners. I think that is an eminently sensible change to make. And I would also support giving the State Board of Elections more authority to make sure that county boards are doing what they're supposed to be doing.
Much of what I would say to this subject is included in my notes. I mean no malice to the state board, but the inspection that we had when they sent a representative out was a courtesy call. It could have been much more elaborate. I am from the military, and I experienced our annual general inspection. And I somehow thought that was what the state could do. That's not where they are now, and I mean them nothing negative. They could do something, as you said, more. My counterpart has been there 13 years. He's extremely professional. He's extremely knowledgeable. He has the support of his party. I was a deputy for 3 years. My predecessor, my commissioner, died in office. I got promoted.
It's okay. Take your time.
We all loved her a lot. But I would say that the New York Association of Counties has a training program that they put their executives through, their administrators, their treasurers, that everybody, there's a track for renewal. Once upon a time, we did much more of that. Now we could enlarge upon that and have a larger training session that would last a week that could be taught by the ECA with input from the Board of Elections. It's something that's very manageable, but the counties have not put their resources into that, nor have we really demanded that something change. We have a very extensive training program for our inspectors. Part of it's they're required to study online, and then they come in for an in-person training session. I explained that we do a lot with our machines. Most of our training after the first initial orientation as a general trainer is all hands-on on how to operate the various pieces of machinery and how to respond to the public when they have needs. So it's not difficult to do if the money comes. And we've always told our legislators when they get heavy-handed, which is rare, that I don't care how much it costs to do an election, they're going to pay for it. It's in the law. We have to run the election. Now we've also sued the budget process by having them all come in and observe. Not all of them do it, but that there's a lot of confidence that the two-party system works, that it's supported by the committee chairs outside of the Board of Elections.
And continuing education would also be a great idea.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the entire panel for your time and for your testimony. The next panel will consist of Scott Forsyth, Sean Waddington, and Pat Domeratz. And again, please correct me if I am pronouncing your name incorrectly. So we will start with Mr. Forsyth whenever you're ready.
Thank you very much, Chairman. My name is Scott Forsyth, but I don't care how you pronounce it. I thank you for the opportunity of testifying today. I'm coming at this issue from the perspective of the consumer, the voter. I'm a volunteer attorney for the Monroe County Democratic Party, one of approximately 35 who helped the unregistered get registered and vote on Election Day. By unregistered, I refer to persons who learn on Election Day or shortly before that they are not in the poll book. They are surprised because many have tried to get registered. Now it's too late to try again because the 20-day window to register has closed. Their remedy is to obtain a court order with our assistance. In my written testimony, I describe the current court order process in this area and how it can be improved upon. Probably the biggest improvement will be same-day registration, which I'm hopeful the people will pass in November, and you will then enact appropriate enabling legislation. By the way, last fall, we obtained approximately 250 court orders for persons who then were able to vote either early or on Election Day. All right. We attorneys also provide another service, enabling registered voters on Election Day to obtain an absentee ballot to vote. They are patients in hospitals, residents of nursing homes, and other shut-ins. They missed the deadline to apply for a ballot, which is the Monday before. So they too need a court order. Here are the words of Michael, a resident of Rochester. Petitioner underwent emergency surgery on 11/2/20 yesterday to address an infection in groin. Petitioner is recovering at strong and is unable to leave the hospital to vote. The attorney helping Michael could not access Strong last fall, so he conducted a video conference. He emailed the completed petition to a social worker who took the petition to Michael to sign before a notary. The social worker returned the petition to the attorney, who then obtained a court order allowing Michael to apply for and received an absentee ballot. Michael successfully voted then. All of this extra labor, including a court order, would not be necessary if you allowed a registered voter to apply for a ballot, an absentee ballot on Election Day. Current law, as I said, limits applications, the last application to be filed the day before. In summary, enacting same-day registration and allowing for applications for absentee ballots on Election Day are just two ways you can remove obstacles to voting in New York. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Forsyth. Next is Mr. Waddington.
Hello, I'm Sean Waddington, and I'm a recent Fairport High School graduate attending Boston University in the fall to study political science. As a politically engaged teen, I was thrilled to see New York's pre-registration law pass. I filled out my application, printed it, mailed it in, But not every young person in the state did as I did, and it's not because of apathy, but a lack of awareness. Gen Z has been on the front lines of protests in cities, small towns, and online, but the lack of know-how and possibly the will to engage the system before turning 18 has prevented many from taking advantage of this policy. It is one thing to pass a positive, progressive law seeking to engage young people, another to meet us where we are to take advantage of the law's purpose. There's an opportunity here on social media for New York to excite an important portion of its electorate. Every few videos on TikTok, millions of teens as young as 13 view ads for products marketed to our age. During the pandemic, we saw ads funded by the government in New York State to promote social distancing, staying home, and more recently getting vaccinated. I believe New York State would be successful at promoting voter pre-registration and registration on social media platforms like TikTok, Instagram, and Snapchat. Again, it isn't that young people don't want to be engaged, but we are truthfully too busy at times to navigate websites or call the Board of Elections. Instead, we are interacting with agencies like New York State Higher Education Services Corporation. While some students qualify for TAP, others like me had to simply fill out the application and send it to colleges to demonstrate our financial need. Could the state senate find ways to integrate registering or pre-registering to vote into applications and agencies like these, the same way we did with the DMV, in order to get more young people to register? New York State also has laws in the book that allow students under the age of 18 to be engaged in the election system. In taking advantage of these laws, it's been my experience at Fairport High School to vote in student council elections on old voting machines and have nonpartisan agencies come into school and attempt to register high schoolers. However, the degree to which someone engages in this is entirely dependent on their mood and their busy schedule. Every high school has stacks of working permits ready to be filled out by students. Could New York State make the same effort with voter registration forms and leaflets on education on how to vote absentee and how to register to vote? Every student has to take a politics and economics class. Could the state senate make available the funding to give every social studies teacher the physical materials needed to register, pre-register, and inform all of their students? I discussed pre-registration, too, as a focus to minimize young people running out the clock on registering to vote. New York State lacks same-day voter registration, so it's entirely possible for an 18-year-old to push off registering to vote just long enough to where they miss a deadline. I had a friend nearly as engaged in politics as I am, and despite it being at the top of her to-do after turning 18 list, she pushed off registering to vote for a couple of months. Young people have so many things swirling around us, vying for our attention, teachers, colleges, counselors, extracurriculars, that sometimes, unless it's right in front of us, we may not do something. Similarly, you may have noticed that I'm moving to Boston. I will be in class 5.5 hours away on Election Day, Tuesday, November 2nd. And I would like to point out how surprisingly difficult it was to actually decipher what day the election was. By no fault of anyone in particular, the 2021 political calendar is rather dense with various deadlines and important dates. I am registered to vote, I am engaged, and I am also a little bit confused. I know there are forms I have to fill out and dates to be aware of to vote in the next election, but I'm also completing online orientation, I'm making shopping lists, and I'm getting ready to move to a different state. As important as it is to me, voting has had to be put in the back burner, and yet I cannot wait too long or I'll miss my chance. The state senate can use a myriad of methods to help students navigate the absentee process. With social media linking complex information to clear, concise advertisements has never been easier. New York's Instagram and Facebook pages can post graphics to teach students how to vote absentee. And I also remind you to look at the classroom and place literature there. Can the state senate give the funding or resources needed to educate students on how to vote absentee? The right to vote is fundamental and young people are craving change, but there is so much noise in our lives. We'd appreciate help in navigating the system. New York State is better than many states in terms of the laws it has passed to seek to engage young people specifically, but these policies require follow-up to meet us where we are in some of the busiest times of our lives. People ages 16 to 24 are demanding change in volumes unlike our parents, and we acknowledge the ballot box is where it takes place. We just need some clarity and increased exposure on how to get there.
Thank you very much. And lastly, Mr. Domerat.
Thank you, Senators, for holding this hearing today on, you know, the preservation of our democracy and the expansion of our franchise. I come as an elected representative of the New York State Democratic Party, representing the 136th State Assembly District, which comprises just over 102,000 voters of all parties or no party, their families, and their non-voting neighbors. I've been active in politics for the last four decades. I started knocking on doors when I was 12 in Central New York. I have six specific proposals that are in my written testimony, and for the purpose of time, I'll narrow it to just two that I think are two of some of the more important. So the Senate and the legislature in general has done a great job, I think, in the last couple of years of coming up with some reforms that were really important to boost confidence in the election process and also to make it easier for people to vote in general and to protect the machinery and the other parts of the physical part of the election. There are two areas, though, that I think could need some work. While there are pretty good regulations around independent expenditures and actions by known entities, be it political action committees or others, what I have found in my own experience, especially in the last few years at the local government level, particularly county and lower, is there has been an increasing attack on candidates of actors that are unknown, nefarious individuals, and they aren't covered by the regulation. Because the assumption is that people will be good actors. They will let you know that they are active in the political sphere and that they are abiding by regulation. And if they don't, there are penalties in the codes. The problem is the individuals or entities are finding ways of attacking candidates days before election day. One of the races in 2019 that was decided by just less than 200 or just over 200 votes was to who would have the majority of this body in the Monroe County Legislature. And it was a candidate that was on our side of the aisle who lost because of one of the reasons anyway was a last minute mailing that attacked his ethno-religious family background. And it caused harm that he could not bounce back from. One is the reality of time, days before an election. And two is because he didn't know who the attacker was because they don't identify themselves and typically use U.S. mail, using stamps, computer-generated labels, and don't identify where they were from or who they are. In the last two election cycles, this has been increasing in the village level, in the town level, in the county legislature level. And in 2018, there was also, 2017, also in the countywide level with the county sheriff's race in Monroe County. What I would recommend is that there be consideration of more than just penalties in a code under election law, but there be, and I don't think this is overkill, there be consideration of criminal penalties, be it misdemeanor, and that would give the candidates the tools to ask law enforcement agencies to look at the physical evidence that has been presented to them by a number of voters, such as postcards, mailings, and other items that are used to defame candidates, their family, and their occupations, in order for them to be stopped and to face, you know, potential justice in court. As well as potentially exposing who the individuals are that could open them up to mail fraud violations. The second thing that I think is important to look at, and I understand that your committee has a specific focus or scope, but democracy is not just a representation of our form of government. It's something we do. It's a verb. And it needs to be protected at all areas, whether it's good government groups, labor unions and protecting the rights of individuals to participate in democratic unions, whether it is protecting human rights organizations and supporting civil society and promoting civic engagement and groups that promote civic engagement. What we need to do is to make democratic action habit forming so that we choose to run for office or choose to go to a zoning board of appeals meeting, and those are exciting, believe me. But they're important. And unless people have confidence that they won't suffer personal attacks, that they have support for being active in their neighborhoods or active in groups supporting open and good government, we will go down the road of having less participation in our government unnecessarily, which will endanger our democracy.
Thank you very much. Senator Brooke.
First of all, thank you all, as always, for everyone for joining us today. I do have to give a special shout out to, I think, our youngest person here testifying, Sean, as your senator. You're very proud to see you here civically engaged. I wanted to, actually, if we start with you, Mr. Waddington, talking about what you talked about with trying to get more young folks involved. And I think you relate it so well that here you are, right, in the middle of your summer as you're getting ready to go to college, spending time to do this, so one could guess you are incredibly engaged, and if there's information to be found, you will find it. And since you're, are you Gen Z? Okay, since you're Gen Z, you could probably find anything online within seconds, right? So the fact that it's hard for you to find things is quite troubling, actually, because then I think about perhaps my 85-year-old grandfather, and where is he going to find information, right? And so I just want you to kind of explain to us how you think it would be different for you or folks your age if, as you say, part of your school, you know, some part of your school day, or as a junior or a senior, you're given this information. What do you think would actually change?
So I think just in general, like a lot of what we have around elections is opt-in, and you have to make the extra effort to go to the Board of Elections like website or the DMV's website or New York State's website. There's a lot of websites to look up, so it's, you know, quick to find things, but it's a hard process to navigate, and a lot of people aren't necessarily willing to take those extra steps. And if that's integrated into schools where teachers have the forms for you, where the guidance office has the forms for you, the information concise for you, it's a lot easier for people to be engaged, and because a lot of people want to be engaged but sometimes lack the time or just kind of keep kicking that can down the road until it's too late. And so I think you'd see just increased participation in people my age, people who want to participate but sometimes just struggle with the managing the different and navigating kind of the bureaucracy of it. And having that in schools would not change anyone's opinions. It's not, you know, adding politics into the classroom, which is a common argument. It's giving kids the information they need in a concise way, because there's a lot of information swirling around. So I think you'd see increased participation with young people.
Thank you. And then I had a question for Mr. Forsyth. Again, thank you for all the work you do locally to re-enfranchise voters. You mentioned that you worked on 200 court orders. Was that for the latest election, or?
Yes, I should have clarified that, for last fall.
Last fall, okay. So that's our last general election. You had 200 court orders. And I'm curious if you can share any information, generally speaking, who are these voters, but what do they represent? Are we talking, are they generally folks who live in the city or the suburbs? Are they generally older or, you know, working parents? Do you have any sort of demographic data on who is represented in those numbers?
I do not have any data. Now you're asking just for a perception. I would say most of the people tend to be younger, diverse backgrounds. I think, yes, there's a fair number coming from the city, but definitely not people like me, older and white. Yes, over time, because I've been doing this since 2008, it does seem to be the younger people, working people from the city, although we do help people from the suburbs too, that need a court order.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Brooke. Senator Rath.
Thank you, Chairman Myrie. And I also want to, Sean, give you some perspective. Mr. Waddington, I guess we'll call you here. He did a wonderful job. And I was impressed with your comments, with your perspective. And I have three kids, 19, 17, and 15. And you're talking their language, let me tell you. and also a fellow political science major. So be prepared to read. Be prepared to write. But I like what you had to offer by way of, as I had said, some thoughtful and creative solutions. And I think that's the way we have to look at just about everything that we're hearing with regards to positive change for administering elections. And we've heard earlier about some challenges with some of the rural and agricultural counties and how they've been creative and maybe finding some different solutions. And I give you credit for taking some 21st century social media ideas. I hadn't heard of that. I think it's a wonderful proposal. So keep it up. You're absolutely doing a great job in thinking through these processes. Do you think, as a question, that if there was a tremendous amount of education and outreach in whatever channels that we went through, that it would significantly increase the participation for 18 to 20 to 25 year olds in the registration process and then in their activism in elections and the political process?
I think it would, because I, you know, just the other day I saw a poll that found Gen Z was more likely to protest than they were to go vote. And when you think about it, it makes sense, because the protest, you just need to make a poster and add your voice to the chorus of people standing up for what they believe in. So the barrier for people trying to vote truly is just the registration process and the process of getting to the ballot. And I think if we use the methods of social media, of the classroom, to get people over that hurdle, I think they'd exercise their right to vote. And I think the trouble is not getting young people to want to become engaged. I think they want to become engaged. I think the barrier truly is getting them through the process. And so I think we would see results if we were to, as a state, try to get people over that hurdle.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Rath, and thank you to the entire panel. I want to congratulate Mr. Waddington on making it to college. Although you are moving to an inferior state, you are going to a pretty good university. So thank you all for your time and your testimony. We're going to take a 5-minute bathroom break before we call the next panel. And so just for those coming to the stage, it'll be Sandy Citarella, Robert Barton, and Kendra Evans, but we will do that right after this 5-minute intermission. Welcome back. Hope everyone was able to use the facilities if you so desired. We have before us now Sandy Citarella, Robert Barton, and Kendra Evans. We will start with Ms. Citarella whenever you're ready.
Thank you very much. Thank you for allowing me to testify. I have discussed much of what is in my written and oral testimony with other current and past coordinators on both sides of the aisle, as well as our and other town clerks and past and current elections inspectors. There were three things that I wanted to talk about now. One is the state holiday for Election Day. You know from previous hearings you have held in other parts of the state, there is a problem with the lack of quality of poll workers or inspectors, and in some cases, workers who don't show. Many responsible employees of state, county, and school districts have expressed to us interest in working at the polls, but unfortunately they cannot do so because their offices, schools, or businesses are open. A state holiday would help improve the numbers of available and quality inspectors and allow more voters to vote in person on Election Day. As mentioned again in my written testimony, most poll workers are seniors or retired citizens. Some have worked the 17-hour day from 5 a.m. to 10 p.m. for over a decade. Most are experienced and excellent at their jobs. Many of these expert inspectors have retired, sadly, because the day is just too long. In Monroe County, we are not allowed to have the day split into two parts. In the 17-hour day, errors are documented mostly at the closing of Election Day. Reconciliation errors, premature locking of machines or blue or red bags in Monroe County. Fatigue-related problems have caused delays in sending data to the boards of elections sometimes by hours. Splitting the day has its pros and cons, which can be discussed at another time, but it should help remove fatigue-related errors. Also, a state holiday would help increase the number of citizens who may choose to be poll workers in a sharing situation. The last thing I wanted to talk about is communication in Monroe County and decisions that have been made. In the past, both the Democratic and Republican coordinators in the town of Pittsford have been and coordinated extremely successful in maintaining a high level of expertise in our inspectors. The Democratic and Republican coordinators have spent many hours making sure competency and work assignments is maintained at all sites and all election and on all election days. We have worked closely with our town clerk to make this happen. This past year, and mostly after January, this responsibility was taken away by the staff and given to the staff at the Board of Elections to our Pittsford town dismay. Primary day in June resulted in much wasted money, time, and effort. Too many election sites were required by the Monroe County Board of Elections for the town of Pittsford. And the result was that in all of our sites, be only between 30 and 50 voters voted on in that 15-hour period. Inspectors were placed in areas that were not in close to their voting locations. And more importantly, experienced inspectors needed by the town were not even selected by the board. And some inspectors who were brought in by outside of the town were not competent or useful in the process. We are hoping to have renewed dialogue to allow towns who have been successful in the election process in the past to be continue with that responsibility and to have, and they have proven to be effective. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Barton.
Good afternoon. My name is Bob Barton. I'm a resident of Fairport. I've lived at the same address for about 13 years, and I've been in various parts of Monroe County as a resident since I was 5 years old. I think it was back in September, my wife went out to the mailbox, as she did pretty much every day, and found several letters that were addressed to each of us respectively, husband and wife, that turned out to be, when she opened it, a ballot for the presidential or the last election cycle. Her first reaction was that, you know, she was quite upset that, you know, we had received this ballot. We kind of followed some of the media reports, and it wasn't totally unsurprising to us that, you know, we had received this ballot even though we did not solicit it. I know that, you know, there was a lot of scandals in other states where ballots were mailed out unsolicited. And so, you know, we said, well, gee, you know, this kind of stinks, but we have absolutely no intention of voting via absentee ballot. You know, we were both retired at that point, or not working, and we had no hesitancy about going to the voting booth. So little surprised that, you know, it happened at all. Certainly I was very upset, but she was just livid. And we looked at the ballot. It appeared to be genuine. It was from the Monroe County Board of Elections, as I recall. It had the envelope, return envelope, that was also addressed with the security signature type of thing on the back, I believe. Although, you know, my memory is a little bit vague at this point. It was a long time ago. But I was just really, really irritated, and she was just livid. So we let it pass. You know, we tended to vote in person. And then about a week later, we get another set of ballots, unsolicited, from this apparently the same source, okay? That just really, really irritated me, okay? And I didn't realize until recently, when I was preparing for this meeting, that New York State apparently did not authorize any unsolicited mailings. I think, am I correct in that, Senators?
So what we did do is here in Monroe County, absentee ballot applications were sent out.
Right.
But you had to request the absentee ballot.
Exactly. And I'm familiar with that. I looked up the absentee ballot application, and I guess there were groups that also, third-party groups, that sent out applications, which is fine. It was an emergency, you know, understandably, and there were going to be some people that didn't want to vote in person. But I was certainly not one of those people, and I did look at that application to see if perhaps by mistake, you know, I had somehow filled out that application for a absentee ballot. And, you know, it was quite clear that I did not. So on two occasions, you know, some error in clerical error, administrative error, or some deliberate effort on the part of, you know, some group that looks to undermine our elections, you know, sought to weight the ballot, in effect, okay, to make it very easy for me to cheat, okay? And I resent that. I resent that. I resent the fact that even when I go to the voting booth, that I don't even have to supply photo ID. That just, I mean, when I go in to buy Wegmans at, I'm 72 years old, I get proofed, okay? I've got to show photo ID if I want to buy beer. You know, a few years back, I fell on hard times. I went down to apply for food stamps at the St. Paul Street facility for social services. I had to have a driver's license to get in there, or photo ID. So every place I go and I see these folks that are saying, well, gee, we should make it easy to, in other states, I just hope that New York preserves the sacredness of the voting process and requires something more than just a signature, because there's obviously people that look to undermine the system. And, you know, they're not folks like you as individuals. I think you're all very admirable candidates, but there's folks that are overzealous, you know, that you know, think that no matter what the price, you know, we're going to get our candidate elected. And in fact, our elections were very close. Our county election for county manager was, you know, a few points. State Senate was a couple of points, you know, spread between the winner and the loser. So, you know, a few hundred of these things printed up would be easy to scam the system. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Barton. And Ms. Evans.
Hello, I'm Kendra Evans. I'm a resident of the town of Pittsford, a community organizer, and the leader of the Pittsford Democratic Committee. I want to thank you all for taking the time to hear testimony today and, of course, for your service. As a whole, I am grateful for the voting reform legislation and applaud the recent changes that have endeavored to make voting in New York easier and more accessible. As a longstanding community organizer in Pittsford, I can attest to the fact that voter participation has increased substantially thanks to these reforms. Yet, and the reason I'm here, is that despite these efforts to make voting more accessible, village elections were overlooked in these legislative updates and have left fellow Pittsford residents crying foul. I implore you to take action to mandate the alignment of village elections with either the scheduled primary or, ideally, the general election. It is a critical need and an essential step in making New York elections more efficient, transparent, and in service to every voter. At this point, we still struggle to get the first Tuesday in November on the radar of Americans. So I'd like to echo what I've heard. Please make that a holiday. So you can imagine how difficult it is to get voters to the polls on March 16th, in the middle of a Rochester winter, and in our case, at a polling location that is different from where these voters cast their ballots in every other election. So this year in Pittsford, we elected our first ever female mayor of the village. It was historic, and as her campaign manager, I am incredibly proud of her success. Yet, only 434 votes were cast in that election. That's less than half of the number of village votes that were cast just months earlier. That is a setback for democracy, in my opinion. And at least in part, I would say it's because the election was in the dead of winter, on a seemingly arbitrary day, resulting in just a minuscule segment of our community deciding who would govern the municipality for the next 4 years. And again, my candidate won. I'm pretty excited about it. But in terms of democracy, this was a setback. So again, village elections should be aligned with the June primary or the general election in November. Aligning the village elections with already scheduled elections will increase voter engagement, ease the burden on the Board of Elections and village clerks, and save taxpayers money. Pittsford is one of six villages in Monroe County that were required to hold elections outside of the scheduled primary or general election. Each village had to man a polling location with six inspectors and at least one Board of Elections technician, sometimes two. Those salaries add up into small municipalities. So I argue that holding village elections in March unnecessarily costs these small villages money and requires additional training of site chairs and election inspectors. Aligning these elections would remove the financial and personnel burden. I assume many have or will testify today regarding the difficulty in securing petition signatures in the dead of winter, and for that reason I won't belabor the point, only to add that in addition to gathering signatures for our local and county offices amid treacherous weather, feet of snow, and a global pandemic, the six villages in Monroe County also had to hold outdoor caucuses and collect signatures in January of 2021, only to have to do it all over again in February. You can imagine how demoralizing that is for volunteers. It's grueling work, it leads to volunteer attrition, suppresses voter turnout, and in my opinion is wholly unnecessary. So it may be argued that village elections are small potatoes, but as a public servant like each of you, we believe that disenfranchising even one voter is too many, let alone the 14,000 voters in Monroe County and the villages across all of our great state. It is our duty to make voting accessible in every election, every year, for every office, and in every community. So we must banish any doubt that elections in New York are anything but fair, free, and accessible to all. So I implore you to please align village elections with a scheduled election. And again, I thank you all for your service.
Thank you very much. Senator Brook.
Thank you again for all of your testimony and for the work many of you do to make sure we have elections administered here. The only comment I just quickly want to address Mr. Barton. I want to encourage you, Mr. Barton. We've done a decent amount of work working here with the Monroe County Board of Elections and our commissioners who are here with us today. We do believe that the Monroe County should not have sent any unsolicited ballots. So I would encourage you, even while we're here today, if you want to, you know, take advantage of this moment to clarify anything with the Board of Election, that's part of the, you know, being accessible to constituents and making sure that that voice is heard. But we certainly hear all of your testimony as well and appreciate you being here. Thanks.
Thank you, Senator Brooks. Senator Rath.
Thank you, Chairman. And thank you to the three of you for your testimony and your comments. Again, it's so very important that we hear all the challenges and all the issues that are out there as we are working on trying to improve the administration of our elections across New York State. And Mr. Barton, I want to talk to you about your comments about voter ID, and I agree with you in many ways that we need to have, I believe, some form of identification when people go to vote. 72% of our states across our country have some form of voter ID, and Monmouth County just did a poll, and 80% of Americans agree that there should be some level of voter identification. And I have proposed legislation, as has Senator Rob Ort, who also represents a portion of Monroe County, to look into this. And we have proposals to pursue this idea, because I think it's important for the sacredness and the integrity of our elections that we have a voter ID mechanism. So I want to applaud you for bringing that forward, because I think it's a very important issue. And I'm amazed that you received multiple absentee ballots. That is not right. It should not have happened. And I agree with you, Senator Brooke, to look further into that. It's very important.
I wish that I would have saved the ballots, but I assumed that, you know, from press releases with other abuses in other states, that this was something that the state legislature had authorized. So had I, you know, known differently at the time, I would have saved those ballots, but they were genuine ballots. I mean, anybody can go out and get a printing press. And, you know, why I was chosen, you know, I could speculate, but that would be all it is, okay? It just makes it very easy for me. Somebody thought that they had a person that wanted to cheat for some reason. That's my guess. Or it was just a really bad administrative mistake on the Board of Elections.
And we've heard a lot of examples where the trust in the system and in our elections has been unfortunately eroded. And us as public officials need to make sure that we restore that trust and do everything that we can. So thank you to all three of you. I appreciate your comments.
Thank you, Senator Rath. And I will echo the thank you to all of our witnesses for your testimony. I do want to address some of the concerns raised by Mr. Barton. One, I would underscore the fact that voter identification is required for you to register to vote. And similarly to you getting a driver's license, once you attain the license, you do not have to present it every time you step into your car or when you drive around. And similarly, the protection that you have, the constitutional right to vote, is not contingent on you presenting identification at every instance where you exercise that right. I would also note that many in 2006, there were no voter ID laws in any state, and that is a recent function of what has happened in some of our court decisions, and I think we have seen extra sort of restrictions post-2013 after the Shelby United States Supreme Court removed protection and preclearance in the Department of Justice for states making certain laws. This is a source of disagreement between me and Senator Rath, which is perfectly fine and okay, but I do want to underscore that the premise that we need ID to vote suggests that there is fraud taking place and that people are fraudulently voting, and there has been no evidence that that is the case and that that is widespread. And so I did want to take the time to say that. But that is perhaps a subject for another day. And I appreciate all of the feedback that we heard from everyone, including you, Mr. Barton. So thank you for your time and for your testimony. Next up, we will hear from Larry Knox, Brian Campione, and Jackie Ortiz. Okay, so it looks like we will be starting with Mr. Knox whenever you're ready.
Thank you. My name is Larry Knox. I'm a political organizer for 1199 SEIU, which is a healthcare workers union. I'm not here speaking officially on their behalf, although I got permission. Speaking just from my experiences, we represent essential frontline workers in hospitals, nursing homes, federally qualified clinics, and other health-related facilities. In my role, I often engage in electoral work on behalf of and at the behest of our members. Representing healthcare workers is an honor. This past year and a half, seeing them persevere often without proper pay, benefits, and most importantly, protections on their job site has been tough. Our members at 1199 are very much invested in what happens on Election Day. The rules, laws, and regulations that are a result of whom is elected on Election Day affect them deeply at home and at work. The absentee voting process we had as a state last year enabled them to not put at further risk their families and coworkers. As you know, many of them, you know, were first in line at being at risk of getting COVID and took many precautions at home and at work. And there was also just concerns about even going out of anywhere besides home and work, and voting was one of those concerns, along with other people, and that the absentee process last year, you know, enabled a lot of them to vote without any early risk or as much risk as also along with that early voting did. This process, as it is in many other states, should be the norm and expanded. So I know a public campaign to educate voters around the constitutional amendments that are on the ballot to provide no excuse absentee and same-day registration is vitally important. While we assume there is public support for these items, unless awareness is greatly increased, it may not be utilized, assuming voters vote yes in November, especially if ballots aren't necessarily going to be mailed if you have to actually request them. Many of our members and families are pushed to civic education and engagement because of the field they're in and the culture of our union. The overall understanding of the electoral process, elected officials, and candidate viewpoints is still, though, too low, and probably even lower than the general public. At least within our union and other unions and people that belong to activist groups, there is engagement from leaders and members of that group. The general public, you know, unless you got that noisy neighbor, somebody in the house that's talking politics, you know, you're not gonna have as much awareness oftentimes of the political policy and just how to vote situation. The unfortunate shrinking of investment into local journalism has also contributed to this. Newspapers, radio, and TV struggle to fund reporters who cover local government and activism as a permanent beat. There are no longer multiple experienced reporters covering different levels of government, business, and community in depth on a weekly basis. So as a result, the voter education understanding that follows that coverage, which was there in the past, as a result, suffers. We have a less informed electorate, you know, no matter what party, no matter where you live. So what are the solutions to that? One potential one is many states offer nonpartisan voter guides. There are groups here that do that, but there are, you know, like League of Women Voters does that, and other parts of the state, there are groups that do nonpartisan voter guides, but in many states, they actually do their own. There should be considerable investment in exploring offering these in New York State, and not just one that online part and then one that would be mailed out. There could be one that would be mailed out prior to every election to every registered voter, and every county could have the opportunity to add local officials for a county specific version. Alaska and Utah have great examples of ones that they do. And again, this just kind of, there's a really low bar of voter education, but at least if people have this in their hand, or if it's text or email, so if it's got to them in a manner that they want, you can at least have the beginnings of people having easy access to who the candidates are. Why do I go to Albany? When do I go to DC? What's this town board mean? What's the city council mean? That basic civic education often isn't there, which means you're not going to be as engaged voting politically, or voting on election day if you're not even sure of who you're voting for and why, even before you get to the parties and issues that you believe in. And I was listening to Sean earlier, and he took some of my thunder. But I think the points he made that I'm about to make, I don't want people to think I'm cribbing from him, but he made them a little more eloquent than I'm about to. But another thing that we've noticed, that boards of elections, especially in smaller counties where everywhere, struggle to meet voters where they are at, especially younger voters. As a union, we are using social media, texting, and other forms of communication to try to meet our members, especially younger ones, where they are at. In the Board of Elections, the state needs to consider doing the same. Exploring more dynamic board election websites. Some of the sites are just, it's 1994, and others, you know, they're maybe a little bit better, but they're not user-friendly. Let alone what happened with the campaign finance website of the board elections is probably a different issue. But you know, just, you know, websites, you know, that are just, you know, more engaging and more accessible to people. And developing apps. I mean, many young people aren't even going to websites that much. They're using apps on their phones. So just, you know, what's the app that the county has, the board elections have, or the state board elections has that's easily accessible for folks? You go on the app and here is everything that you need to know. And here are some updates that come up with notifications on that. Hey, don't forget, today's the deadline to register to vote. Or hey, next week is election day. You know, nothing partisan about who to vote for, but just those deadlines, the calendar, the political calendar that we all know about in this room. But most normal folks, like our friends, are like, what are you doing again politically? Have no idea about, you know, those reminders or an app that kind of, you know, easily reminds people of that on their phone. I think is something that should be explored. Along with texting. And then we can use experts from the state, you know, social media world, or universities that, you know, to help build that. I'm sure there's people within the state, but a lot, especially in New York, there's experts, you know, all across the state that can help build something that works. And I think it's important to remember, like the first time I was in these chambers speaking, I was high school student in 1990, whatever. But I was like, you know, 13 or 14 years old. And a lot of the folks in this room that are testifying, we're more politically engaged, but most people aren't. Like even with my union, our members, they're members of a union, they're engaged. But again, people that aren't in a union or part of an activist group, people are like, what are you doing? We don't understand this whole thing we're talking about. So remembering that as we're doing this work and as you as a state are considering how to reach people, remember the folks that aren't even think of attending this meeting, aren't going to watch the live stream, aren't going to, you know, ask anybody, did you see what happened when the state Senate election committee came, and how do we get them engaged? Because it's, you know, we often are speaking to each other about things that, you know, are relatively important for prime voters or who we're trying to reach, but most of the universe has no idea what that means. And I think if, as technology moves and as the world moves, if we're not moving forward as with the ways we reach out to people electorally and educate them, it's like then you become like a dinosaur. We're going in the wrong direction. Even if we just do things and stay the same, we're already behind. We're already behind with people that are between the ages of 18 and 35 who are doing activism in other ways and not voting. How do we reach them? And I think as we go forward, as the work is done of your committee, as we look at ways to support boards of elections with ways of doing outreach, that we remember that we don't want to get behind technologically with the work. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Ortiz.
Good afternoon. My name is Jackie Ortiz, and I am the new Monroe County Democrat Board of Elections Commissioner. Jumping into the role only 60 days before the November general of 2020 has certainly been a journey. We understand there has been discussion regarding the reform of board leadership and operations. The notion of eliminating the bipartisan nature of boards is absolutely not in the best interest of the voters. Practically speaking, if there was a countywide election, would we have commissioner or commissioners presiding over their own elections? I don't know if that makes sense. If instead the decisions were placed in the hands of county government or legislatures, that would undoubtedly be political in nature and surely is not the correct direction. Boards of elections should not be political footballs. The civil service option sounds perhaps favorable in concept, but until someone can convince me that the system operates nimbly, I certainly don't think that might work either. Last year, we hired over 50 temporary workers to complete the voluminous amount of applications that we received for absentees and had to process those within less than 30 days in order to achieve timeliness for every single voter. I don't think with the HR hurdles that that particular system provides that we would ever have been able to do that quick turnaround to be able to, again, service all voters in a timely fashion. Bipartisan operations serves all voters, and having a dual set of commissioners protects election integrity. Laws are ever-changing, and technology is playing a more prominent role in our operations. All staff needs training, and our systems must be updated appropriately. There are real costs associated with these reforms, which means every piece of legislation that comes our way cannot continue to say no budgetary impact. We all support more access and opportunity for voters, but still, our budgets, which have traditionally hovered around $7 million annually in Monroe County, have in the last 2 years reached a new plateau of approximately $10.5 million. When the legislature passes down unfunded mandates, it is our voters who pay the price. Reform and enhanced access must require more resources. Access for voters is essential, and early voting has undoubtedly proven that the concept of any voter going to any location is possible and successful in execution. The legal requirement that voters go to their specified site on election day should be changed to this exact same format. This change would eliminate voters from being turned away from accidentally going to the wrong site because every site would be the right site. Election day could essentially be changed to election week, and we can achieve economies of scale and yet still provide ample access. Coupled with consistent hours of 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., it would also reduce confusion, and we would not have as arduous of the day with the current 17-hour structure that you've already heard about a few times. Absentee voting was a huge success in 2020, at least we think so in Monroe County, providing an additional avenue for participation. However, as we increase opportunities and methods for voting, we must be sure not to inadvertently place barriers in voters' way. It is clear mailing absentee applications significantly increased turnout last year. Those who voted by absentee last year but did not vote at all this year is estimated at approximately 28,000 voters. One could say that local primaries naturally have less turnout, but yet, excuse me, we could also argue that by providing the applications directly to homes eliminated the need to seek out the application, eliminated the need to have internet access or access to a printer, thus improving voter participation. A simple solution would be to provide applications as part of the annually mandated verification letters to households moving forward. We must be cautious of passing laws without mandating the promulgation of rules and regulations regarding their execution. With the passing of the automatic recount provisions that were buried in the budget, we found ourselves having to recount not one, two, three, four, five, six, but seven election contests this past year. If this is going to be the new norm, we must truly think about providing the most accurate, efficient, and consistent way of executing. At this time, it is possible to have 62 variations regarding execution, with 62 counties in New York determining how best to comply. Does that instill voter confidence? Particularly in races that span multiple counties. The second check should not be relegated to a process that is ripe for human error and potentially inconsistent determinations. There is no way the antiquated process of essentially using hundreds of paper grids, pens, tally tick marks, and transposing hundreds of sheets to a master tally sheet as somehow the gold standard for counting ballots. If that was the case, I ask, why do we use machines at all? We should all be pushing for even better technology that accounts for more sensitive variables to be able to accomplish this task. We already allow for state-certified tools to assist in completing the mandated manual audit as part of the re-canvas. There should be no reason not to allow for this same independent system from election day machines to assist in this undertaking. And oh, since we tried them all, it's important to note the outcome of the first manual recount assisted by the state certified tool was exactly the same as the original for election day. And subsequently, the hand recount yet again provided the exact same outcome. So what we accomplished in one day could have provided the second check needed, but instead had to undertake a long, drawn-out process that took a week and a half and 18 staff members for the same result. We trust and believe that the public wants nothing more than accurate counts and processes that do not squander both time and taxpayer dollars. We humbly request that the law be amended.
Thank you very much. Senator Brooke.
Thank you both for your testimony today. Thank you, Commissioner Ortiz, for everything you've done to administer our elections here locally. The only comment I have, you know, I think you've laid out very clearly. I look forward to working with you more as we think about how to move forward. And, you know, as someone who comes from, before being elected, working in technology, we are fighting that fight to get more advanced technology through some of our elections. And I agree with you, Mr. Knox, whether it's an app or a TikTok ad, whatever it is, I know there's probably more we could do to be more accessible to folks. So thank you both.
Thank you very much. I look forward to Senator Ratt's TikTok on today's hearing. Senator Ratt.
You're the chairman. Aren't you supposed to lead by example here? Thank you to both of you for your comments and your testimony. Commissioner Ortiz, I also want to thank you for the work that you and everyone does at the Monroe County Board of Elections. You were faced with huge challenges last year, and you all rose to the occasion. And you made a comment about how the bipartisan nature of the administration of the Board of Elections is working. And I completely agree. There is equal oversight, there is checks and balances, there is a real sense of cohesion. And like I said, professionalism, and it's very, very well organized here in Monroe County, and I give you all a lot of credit for that.
Thank you.
I think that if there's one thing that we've heard consistently over the past couple days, it's that the bipartisan model works, and it works very, very well. And I wanted to touch on what you had talked about, the $7 million budget escalating to $10.5 million. Well, that's a 50% increase, if I'm doing the math right in my head. That's a huge increase. And earlier on, I had talked about how New York State only set aside $25 million for our boards of elections, and it was woefully inadequate. And this is yet again another suffocating unfunded mandate for our counties. Coming from county government before the state Senate, I know. What do you think, is a reasonable or an adequate amount of money that Monroe County would need to successfully administer their elections? And I know the challenges are different in off years versus on years per se.
Right. I think that's actually a very difficult question to be able to answer, because it really will all depend on what type of reforms are, you know, placed our way in order to be able to execute as everyone would like us to be able to do. The majority of what we've seen in terms of our increase are increases in hiring staff to be able to, again, be able to meet the challenge of processing applications, be able to, as what was mentioned here a few different times, put resources into our training department. As everyone has stated, it has been very difficult to be able to recruit individuals. So I echo the state holiday, quite frankly, national holiday for that. But at this point in time, it's a little difficult. I would say where we have reached right now is somewhat sufficient versus where we were regarding all of the new reforms that have occurred. Certainly we could use a little additional because what we're anticipating with some of the other changes, the expansion of early voting, the passing of the no excuse absentee, the same day registration, it's difficult to be able to anticipate exactly what those costs might look like. So clearly at the $10.5 million we plateaued to will certainly not be enough if some of these other reforms come our way. So hard to say, but the more that comes our way, the more we will need.
I realize it's very hard for the local boards of elections to administer the 100 changes to the election law that we've seen over the past couple of years. So thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you both for your time and for your testimony.
Thank you.
Next, we will hear from Dr. Matthew Witten, Paul Wolf. Well, actually, I know Paul is unable to testify. Nicholas Wilt and Jeremy Scheer. Okay, so we'll start with Dr. Witten whenever you're ready.
Hi, I'm Matthew Witten, a musician, teacher, activist, and city resident, member and supporter of the Working Families Party. In general, I'd like to reiterate some of the things that I've heard today. I think elections and voting should be easier. Same-day registration, no-excuse absentee ballots are awesome. Thank you for those improvements. But how about mail-in ballots for everyone? And early voting always possible, any location, any time. Election day should absolutely be a national holiday. While I realize that that might be a bit of a stretch for now, how about New York State has a national holiday? No one should need to schedule around their job to get to polls. Let's celebrate voting. I know that some of these changes are scheduled to be made soon. I'm aware of the progress, and I thank the legislature for already improving those measures and hope that voters will agree in the fall. I know that this will be a fight, but Maine, Vermont, and D.C., Washington, D.C., allow incarcerated people to vote. We should do this also. The process for new candidates should be easier, fair and equal, not partisan with the current patronage system, but professional, an unbiased group of hired professionals to be objective and inclusive, not subjective and exclusive. Third parties should be able to access Board of Election with less roadblocks and hoops to jump through, more fair regulations and transparent policies and process. Consistent rule-based decisions should be required. No unfair, unwritten standards at the whim of the commissioners. regulated standards, and clear polling site rules regarding training, visibility, and changes to poll sites. All of these things, I think, need to be as clear as possible. There need to be mandated rules to just make sure that there's no confusion, there's no misunderstandings, there's no mistakes made, and that the trainees know exactly what they're supposed to do. I would also extend all of this to safety and COVID protocols. As the Delta variant is surging, we want to make sure that workers and volunteers are safe, as according to the CDC findings. Requiring vaccines and mask requirements to me would be, I think, a step in the right direction. I would really love to see gerrymandering made illegal, ensure fair and nonpartisan drawing of districts in the state and local levels, place restrictions on state, county, city, town, all. Legislation to protect New York voters even more than the potential protection by the Pending for the People Act, that all citizens should be pushing their representatives on every level of government to pass this right now as possible before, as soon as possible, before gerrymandering can occur. Let's have New York lead the way and set the example for the rest of the country on voting rights.
Thank you very much. Mr. Wilt.
I'm going to start at the end of the written submission and say that we can consider elections to be sort of large-scale job interviews with many constituents weighing in on who should get the job. And the unifying theme of the three proposals in my written submission are, okay, sorry about that. They all address that consideration. So the first one is easy because until recently, I hadn't even realized that it was legal for the county chair of a county committee to also serve as the elections commissioner of that same county. I'm like, that's an easy layup. There ought to be a law that should be prohibited. I think there also, that idea can be extended to, for example, members of the executive committee of the county committee. It can be extended to, no offense, but present company not excluded, the idea of elected officials serving in those capacities. It's the job of party leadership to recruit, develop, encourage, and support the candidacies of candidates for public office, and to so there are some conflicts that seem obvious in terms of supporting that endeavor while also serving in these other capacities. In a related consideration, we have now three straight years of reduced signature requirements for ballots for candidates to secure ballot access. I think, if memory serves, 2019 had a modest reduction, maybe 20%, because we had moved the primary calendar. And our town leader of the town of Pittsford, Kendra Evans, alluded to the difficulties of seeking these signatures in the Rochester winter, as opposed to in June, when the September primaries were in force. But then with COVID, we had 2 years of much reduced signature requirements. And here in Rochester, we had a proliferation of candidates. The citywide city council race had 19 candidates petition themselves on, and 16 of them survived the sort of rigorous ballot challenge process that often takes place. And the outcome of the election was perfectly reasonable. You know, people were absolutely able to sift through who were the best candidates to get the power. And the primary is the election, effectively, in the city of Rochester. So I think, given that and given some other results with crowded fields, the people have shown the capacity to sift through larger numbers of candidates and make sound decisions. And I think one way for the legislature to support that would be to make the reduced signature requirements that facilitated this effectively natural experiment that happened last year and this year a permanent fixture in New York's democracy. And further extending the, and this is where I have to say I'm a software engineer and I think about algorithms a lot, and ranked choice voting is a policy that the more I study it, the more I like it, because it is an elegant way to resolve these types of elections where there are crowded fields, whether you're trying to identify one winner or even multiple winners, in because once a winner achieves the 50% threshold, they can be taken out of consideration. And essentially what it does is it reduces the number of ballots that need to be cast. I love Jackie. I think we wound up with a great elections commissioner, but as I reiterated in my written testimony, we had 9 candidates vying for that position, and I think many of them withdrew because it's really hard to think that how are you going to get the majority of a weighted vote of a county committee. We have borne witness to actual elections that were administered without COVID, where multiple ballots had to be cast, and sometimes this also happens in designation votes, into the wee hours of the night. And I don't think anybody's learning anything about these candidates between rounds of balloting. The ranked choice proposal, and there are some details that would probably have to be codified in state law. It would have to be studied, and you would need like algorithms guys to try to narrow it down exactly how to do it. But from a user standpoint, the voters would be able to cast a single ballot, and then a more complicated counting process ensues. So you're relieving the burden on the voters and putting a slightly larger burden on the folks administering the election. But I think overall, you would get a more just outcome and it would serve our democracy well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Senator Brook.
Thank you both for your testimony. Mr. Welt, thank you for these thoughtfully, I think, put together proposals and plans. I think definitely a lot of this are things that we are thinking about, and I think every voice that we can add to that to know that it's at the top of minds of voters is really helpful. So thank you both.
Thank you. Senator Rett.
Nothing other than a thank you to both of you for coming in and your thoughtful testimony. It's appreciated.
Thank you for your time and for your testimony. Our penultimate panel will consist of Mercedes Vasquez Simmons, Belen Colon, and Anthony Plonsinski Figueroa.
He's not even an upstater and he did that.
I know. Well, I mean.
Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes. But we're going to wait 1 second to get the other speaker.
This is my mother.
Hi, Mom.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak, and thank you for allowing this platform to exist. My name is Mercedes Vasquez Simmons. I am a candidate, a Democratic candidate for County Legislator District 22. But I'm speaking on behalf of my other responsibilities. I serve as secretary to the Latino Voter Protection Group, also assistant director to the Hispanic Community Center for the Elderly at Los Flamboyanes, and I'm the daughter of a civil rights activist. As part of my responsibility with the Hispanic Community Center is to ensure that Latino rights are not violated. Latinos are the second largest group, right? I'm sorry, Rochester has the second largest Latino group outside of New York City. My focus was again to ensure that our rights were not violated. In the last 5 years, I've registered hundreds of individuals, particularly Latinos and Puerto Ricans, shortly after Hurricane Maria, to ensure that they had a right to vote. So we registered them to vote. We've provided training, and we've provided advocacy to ensure that they're exercising their rights to vote. In the primary, June 2020, presidential primary, I called the Board of Elections to ensure, and it was just a few days prior to the actual primary, I called the Board of Election to find out, and I'm sorry, to confirm that we were going to have a translator at Los Flamboyanes. Los Flamboyanes is a housing unit that has probably one of the largest Latino population it services. And it's been a long time polling site. I was surprised to learn that that poll site was removed. We didn't receive notification of it. I work in the building. I spoke with the building management, and we didn't receive notification of it as well. I quickly called our interim commissioner at the time, Lashana Booth, to find out what was occurring, if this was actually true. After several days, she did return my call and said it was because of COVID. I asked her what was her plan to ensure that the voters were informed. I believe her response was she was going to put something on the door. Now, I was quickly alarmed. My voters, particularly in that area, most of them are elderly. I was thinking, how are we going to get all these voters moved in such a short period of time? In a way to help relieve some of the stress, I decided that I was going to vote early. I went to a poll site, and as I was approaching the poll sites, I'm trying to contact as many people, and I was having a conversation in Spanish as I was walking to a poll site. Now, keep in mind, I made three attempts to vote that day. In two of the attempts, they couldn't find my name. I've been voting for several years now. I didn't understand why why my name didn't appear in the electronic system that they upgraded to. I didn't have time to argue. I didn't have time to call BOE. I said, I'll come back during my lunch hour. I came back to during my lunch hour. I was having a conversation with another voter that I was encouraging them to vote early, only to find that a poll worker was upset that I was on my phone speaking Spanish. He went as far as grabbing my hand and pulling me, trying to remove my cell phone from my hand. At this point, I had not even approached the registration point where I was giving the name. It was very upsetting to me. I didn't understand why this man would assault me in that form. Simply just asked me, hey, can you turn off your phone? But he made it became a persistent issue that my entire time there. When I approached the site, I gave them my name, and again, I had issues. What I realized that being a Latina, I have two last names, that was an issue. For some reason, the poll site said, well, you should only have one last name. I don't think as a Latina that I should be limited. My name is what my name is. As I proceeded to go through the entire process, this gentleman continued to tell me that I needed to give him my cell phone, and then he was going to notify the interim commissioner, Lashana Booth, about my conduct, I guess, at the poll site. I didn't understand why this was happening. I'm fortunate that I speak two languages, that I was able to communicate to them, just saying, I'm trying to help another voter with an issue. I'm not doing anything outside of what I thought was the right thing to do, which was to communicate to him and to the voter what we were doing. It was a very traumatic experience, you know, to be assaulted as I was exercising my right to vote. I'm just, four takeaways is invest in a system that will allow Latino voters to have their full name, have multiple last names or two last names. Ensure that there's translators, because there wasn't a translator at that location. Invest in training. The poll workers that were there clearly weren't familiar with the new system, the iPads. And lastly is diversity training. I think that's so greatly needed. The mere fact that I was told that I should only have one last name showed me that she was insensitive to the fact that our culture often has two last names. Thank you again for the opportunity.
Thank you. Yeah. And did I say your last name right, Mr. Ponsinski Figueroa?
Yes.
Okay.
And I am Latino, and I also have two last names.
I think she's next.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Mi nombre es Belén Colón. Soy puertorriqueña. ¿Tú sabes español?
I understand it. I don't speak it as well as I should.
And I have to tell you, this is some of the issues that we encounter.
Mm-hmm.
When we go to poll sites, we don't have someone there that mm-hmm. can speak Spanish. Mm-hmm. So what happens to the voter? Mm-hmm. They walk away.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry to interrupt.
Okay. I came here in 1964. They made me take an English test to register. I worked hard that year for the people who live in the building that I used to live to have the right to vote because we are United States citizens. And I want that. They register, they have the right to vote. I've been involved in politics is nothing for 57 years. I was an inspector for many years. I used to help a lot of politicians. Some of them, Pedro Maneiro, Nancy Padilla, Gary Proud, Glenn King, and more. And most of the politicians know me, and because I'm a troublemaker. Maybe because I'm a troublemaker. I'm everybody's mother. Everybody's mother. First of all, I was very disappointed because my place to vote is Los Flamboyanes. But we have to go to Baden Street. A very small place. And I went there with a Hispanic lady. I didn't know English, but wasn't no interpreter in there. I went in, and I know that I went and signed and gave me the paper. I was so excited that day because Hilda, a Puerto Rican lady, was running. I mean, I was completely amazed. None, because she's Puerto Rican, and she's a woman, two times, Puerto Rican woman. Then when they gave me the paper didn't say, I kept looking and looking and looking for that name wasn't there. And then I decided to sit down. See, I want to see her name. Because I mean, there were other candidates there that I love, and I was willing to vote for, but Hilda was my candidate. And I kept asking them, and they kept like pushing me. Then I decided to sit down. I'm not moving until I see her name here. And they keep pushing me, and treating me like a piece of garbage. I've been involved with politics since I came to America. I registered Latin, Spanish-speaking Puerto Rican people, Puerto Rican lady, to have the right to vote. Because we are citizens. We have the right to vote. And I was giving them the interest. I was giving them to be proud to vote. We have that. We have seen in other countries they cannot vote. We have the right to vote, and always registering people, most of them Hispanic speaking community. And that day, they want me to go. Go to the machine to vote. Go to the machine to vote. They want to get me out of my chair, out of the chair where I was sitting. The people were in those places, they weren't capable to do a good job on those machines. But and I didn't want to vote without Hilda's name in that paper. At the end, they make me go to the machine. They make me write her name in a way that in a line that she had no business to be with. And then after that, I went and put the paper in there. After that, I don't know what happened.
The machine rejected it because it was multiple.
I've been happy all my life. That day I was so disappointed because when I've been young, they had so much respect for me. I'm old now. Then I'm a piece of garbage. They treat me like a piece of garbage, and that hurts me because I wasn't the only one. There are a lot of Spanish speaking my age that they have the right to vote, but because they're scared to be treated the way they treat me, they don't want to go and vote. But for me, that was very disrespectful. That the Democrat, my Democrat people, treat me like a piece of, like I was. See, I was very important the time that I was young, that I can work. But that day that I was, the day that I feel more proud, the Puerto Rican lady was running for, they treat me like a piece of garbage. And I don't think that's right. I don't think. You hear me so much that I can't take it out of my heart, out of my mind. I have nightmares thinking about that day, the way that people treat me. They make the other people go and vote. You have to go and vote. And people that they don't know that much about politics, but just vote. They vote knowing that Hilda's name wasn't there, but not me. I cannot vote. Hilda was my candidate. Puerto Rican lady, we are United States citizens. We have the right to. We have the right to run and to be respected. But they didn't. They treat me like I was a piece of garbage. It's very, very hard. But I still registering people and giving people the reason. One vote. Be proud. You are a United States citizen. You Puerto Rican. You have the right to vote. Go on. Register and vote. I always say with the people, register. People that don't register, I call them losers. You're a loser. You gotta be a winner. You have to register. You both have to count for whatever. We cannot ask for anything if we don't have if we don't vote. And I don't care what they did to me. It hurts. But as long as I'm alive, Belen Colon is gonna vote.
We're gonna get to our third witness, but I just want to say to you, Ms. Colon, that what happened to you is unacceptable, that we should not tolerate that treatment for any voter in the state of New York, but certainly not someone like yourself, who has been fighting for the right to vote since there were literal literacy tests that you had to take. The Voting Rights Act that was passed was in response to some of these very tests that prevented people like you from having access to the ballot. And that right was eviscerated by the Supreme Court in 2013, and we have a job to do here in the state of New York to ensure that we don't allow things like this to happen to anyone, because you deserve better. And everyone that looks like you that speaks like you, that jokes like you, deserves to have access to the franchise equally. And so I want to apologize on behalf of the state of New York that you had to go through that. And I want to commend you for your courage to speak about that experience to this committee today. And so we are going to ensure, and we're going to work very closely and in a detailed fashion to ensure that something like this never happens to you or anyone else again. So I want to thank you for your testimony. And we will hear from our third witness, and I will allow my colleagues to address the panel.
Do you want to?
No, you can.
Okay. I won't lie. I may need a minute myself, you know, here in Berlin. Yeah. Well, it's like you, when you're in the community, you hear your mom cry.
Mm-hmm. You can take the time you need.
I love you.
But you may not have known it, but you just met the mayor of Clinton Avenue in Rochester, New York.
She worked with John Lewis to ensure that literacy exam was removed.
Mm. Yeah. It's very hard to follow, but the reason why I'm here today and others is I stand on the shoulders of giants like Belen Colon. And hearing about what you hear about in this community and growing up, you come with a certain level of pride. My background is 100% Rochester. I'm Polish and Puerto Rican. If you know where Hudson Avenue is and Clinton Avenue is, they're not too far off. I like to joke that somewhere in the middle out came Anthony Plonzinski Figueroa and the rest of his family. To put us all together, the Latino community has many different groups within the community. But in 2013, we said to ourselves that we're not communicating with each other. And so we created a forum, a group, not another 501c3, not another organization, but a meetup called La Cumbre, and so Latinos United for Progress, and it was to address issues like this. And in 2013, we ramped up our voter registration outreach and our civic engagement and civic education, because the education piece is very important to address these concerns. And what we found within the ranks of voting and the areas out there are not any different, and I can't be a better messenger for that than Midlanders in terms of what they saw at the polling places. It was no later, than 2017 when the Department of Justice was here on the ground in Rochester, specifically because Spanish-speaking voters were being turned away and Spanish-speaking interpreters were being dismissed from polling locations because polling site workers did not understand the purpose that they served, or they didn't follow the training that they received at the time. And so the Latino community and the Spanish-speaking community has endured a lot of these training issues, cultural issues within our community for a very long time. So it makes the fight that much more personal and that much more evident. You could look no different in terms of having Spanish-speaking interpreters. Is that part of it is that they're the growing nature of the need and the growing nature of whether they're available doesn't meet and it doesn't align. And a big thing that has to do with that is the fact that our poll workers are a temporary job. Their pay is not, there's not a lot, and it happens during the workday. So often what we're finding is that retirees, individuals who are unemployed or part-time employed and not full-time employed, are taking on these jobs. And then the individuals, especially within the Spanish-speaking community, to decide to take on that job, they may be risking the fact that their level of benefit, their housing security, their health care, their food security is going to be challenged, because if they take this job, even though it's one day of work, if they make an extra $10, the level of service that they're making just to make ends meet is going to be taken and stripped away from them. So often in terms of how we engage in the community and how we're making those choices within the community in terms of civic engagement is a difference between, do I serve my community or do I survive? And that should not be a choice that anybody has to make. within a community. And that's just not a Rochester problem. That is a Buffalo problem. That is a New York City problem. That is a Syracuse problem, Yonkers, and get on and on and on. And so it's a community problem where folks are choosing whether to be civically engaged or they're willing to survive because of the way that these parts are set up. So I definitely echo, we definitely echo the idea of a national holiday or a state holiday for voting to allow more individuals to participate. You should not have to choose survival over civic duty. It's ludicrous. In 2020, you heard the story. The words that I have on this paper, and we didn't talk ahead of time, is that the primary in 2020 in Monroe County was a profile in chaos. The way that that election was run, the way that the community was run, that the community was treated in the way it was run, was completely unfounded. And at the heart and the center of that was something that is coming up now, is that how do we choose our Board of Elections commissioners? And I say without a shadow of a doubt that to give the Monroe County Legislature or any county legislatures more power to play political football with the Board of Elections and the choosing of the Board of Elections would be completely insane. What we saw in 2020 was a manipulation of power, was a manipulation of choice, and that they tried to strip the choice of the Democratic commissioner to be chosen by rank and file voters to be chosen in a back room by 14 individuals. That internal squabble and that public fight that it became led to rank and file voters having to sue their own government and winning, and then also holding an election that the leader of the time at that time did not recognize. And so for 60 days we sat without a commissioner of the Board of Elections that was coming in that the people chose right before one of the most contentious and consequential elections of our lifetime in the general election. Now where we sit today and where we are today in terms of the strides that we've made, the election of Commissioner Ortiz and the work of her and her team, Deputy Commissioner Ali Shepard, has been a pleasant change, but there's still much more to do and there's still much more to support what is going there. So one of the COVID protocols we talked about are the COVID protocols that are in place is that the salaries and the wages that election workers make did not count against them in terms of their benefits and their IRS standard. And I think that needs to be explored at a state and the federal level, especially given the small amount of money that they're given to just allow them to work that day. We should think about how are folks choosing survival over or civic duty. The other thing here that's prevalent everywhere is that the Board of Elections needs more money and our community needs more money to find adequate staff and training to ensure that election workers don't do what just happened there. And I put it out there that training is pivotal. Cultural diversity is pivotal. And I think our Board of Elections are struggling with that in focusing on that, but we need more help. And we need to ensure that that ability and that resource is there for folks to take advantage of. And so those are my big three takeaways. There's more help and training for the Boards of Elections to ensure that the political football is not turned, the Board of Elections is independent and it's not turned into a political football, and that more power is not given to county legislature so that they can manipulate the Boards of Elections, and to ensure that we're working together to ensure that different cultures are adequately responded to at the polling place. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Senator Brook.
First of all, I want to thank all three of you for providing not just, again, thoughtfully prepared remarks, but really moving testimony. Pero voy a intentar a saludar a la señora Colón. Gracias por todo lo que has hecho por nosotros y el derecho de votar. Gracias por estar aquí con nosotros. Yo sé que es tal vez muy difícil para usted. Y espero que podamos trabajar juntos para avanzar lo que estamos hablando hoy. Gracias.
Thank you, Senator Brook. Senator Rath.
Thank you, Chairman. And thank you to the three of you for your very, very important and moving and critically timely testimony. And to Ms. Colon, your right to vote should never be infringed. It should never be jeopardized. And you should never have to go through what you went through here in Rochester, and anyone should never have that experience. This is precisely the kind of testimony that we need to hear so we can bring about real and effective change to improve our elections processes. And rest assured that we will not forget what you said. And also, I encourage you to continue to keep on making trouble, because you're making very good trouble in your community right now. Absolutely. And you know, I think that for us as members of the Elections Committee, we take notes, we pay attention to the testimony. Now it's time for us to go to work and to bring about action that's going to improve and guarantee this nightmare never happens again.
Thank you all again very much for your time, and thank you for your testimony. So before we call up the last panel, I just want to make one final call for a few of the witnesses who did not respond when I called them earlier. Priscilla Perdue, Brian Campione, and Jeremy Scher. Okay, so we will now call up our last panel, Bruce Sprague and Jane Malwitz.
Need bigger desks.
Okay, Mr. Sprague, whenever you're ready.
No, thank you. This testimony is really a collection of topics that me and my friends discuss regarding the New York State election process, well, national elections as well. Some of these are first-hand observations, others are questions that I can just never seem to get answered. The New York State election process, near as I can tell, has never been audited. It's just an added technology over the years, computerized voting networks, internet, Wi-Fi, electronic post-processing, ballots, paper products, et cetera. And because of all these additions, nearly every procedure of the election process has been modified along the way. We've added rules, polling places, procedures, new staff, training methods. We've piled new laws on top of the backs of old laws, or change existing laws, however that all works. And the only proof of the process is in the procedure is the election itself. Do we really know what we have? Do we really know what's inside the black box that nobody can ever see inside? And because of that, the people that I associate with and the people that I know, we just don't trust the process anymore. 2020 harbored in, as near as I can find, there was 32 New York State executive orders instituted for COVID. That's what that was all for. Were these legal according to New York State Constitution? What happens to these executive orders in the next election? What happened to our election in 2020 as a result of these executive orders? People received ballots in the mail. One gentleman spoke of that here. Then there was a second mailing, as I understand, because there was an error made with the first one. So now there's two of these things floating around. Do we know that the correct ballot was used if these people elected to use those? Could both of the ballots have been sent back in? Could the wrong ballot have been used to cast a vote? How many of these mailed ballots were sent the first time? The second time, how many were actually used? And some people, again, showed up to vote on November 3rd only to be told that they'd already voted. How can this be if they didn't send in a paper ballot? How is the lockdown in nursing home residents vote, how are they taken? My mother-in-law is a nursing home resident, and by the diligence of her family was able to get a vote taken on a paper ballot. But what happened to that paper ballot? Did it get tallied? Where did it go? We just don't know where that went. And what is the process for these voters, and especially during a lockdown? What is that process for those people to vote in these nursing homes? I'm sure there is a process. It just seems like it was all convoluted this last year. We don't have IDs to vote, and they should be required. I just recently went to a Greece school board meeting and I had to show my driver's license just to get in to look at the meeting. Shouldn't I need that to vote? I think no less. Most voters already have a license or some ID to get services in so many places that you have to show to do that. I think voting is just essential. And currently, one of the only available methods for a person to be validated when they vote is their signature. And in 2020, these electronic signatures were taken on an iPad device, which I don't know about you, but when I sign on a piece of glass, it does not look like my signature. So if these signatures then are used to go back in and replace existing signatures that are already on file, that just messes that process up, so you don't have even a signature that looks like a signature that's replacing. Anyway, sorry, I don't speak well in front of people either.
You're doing great.
Sorry. And I have to look at my notes because my brain isn't what it once was. Because of all the questions and inconsistencies, I suggested that we do a forensic audit modeled after that, what is being done in Maricopa County, Arizona, minus all of the interference and the lack of cooperation that they're getting. Audit the processes, the procedures, the voter registrations, the materials, the paper products, the use of Sharpie markers. Is that something we should be looking at? Everything for the New York State elections and all counties in New York State and compare that against the 2020 election results. Machine settings. Are we being hacked? Do we know if we're being hacked? I recently went to vote in the Hilton school election. Just for the heck of it, I took my phone out and there was about 15 Wi-Fi networks going on there. Any one of them could be the one that hacks into the machine. Anyway, I suggest we remove all the voting devices and all the electronic post-processing and replace with paper ballots across New York State. Suggest too that we send our state legislatures and our election experts to the Mike Lindell Cyber Symposium on August 10th, 11th, and 12th. And if you need volunteers for these audits, I think the scrap metal income from scrapping all of our voting machines would bring in some money, and we could use that to offset some of the cost. No network, software, maintenance, we could probably reduce some staff and save some money there. And then there's another group of people that you could call on for that. You could train gray hairs like me, retired guy that wants to do something for my country and my state. I'm sure we could round up an army of those people. Just many people feel strongly that there was wrongdoing done in our 2020 election nationally, and I'm guessing that it's also in the state. So let's take a look under the hood and see what's going on. We just want all of our New York residents to have their vote counted once for the candidate of their choice. That's all I want. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Mollis.
Hi. I'm sorry. Good afternoon. I would like to thank you for the opportunity to provide testimony to the Senate Elections Committee regarding my experiences voting in the 2020 elections. Thank you for your patience as well, as public speaking is not my forte or in my comfort zone, but I believe this is too important to avoid. I am just an ordinary citizen, a wife, a mom, a taxpayer. Those that have known me for a while know that I've always stood for what is right, regardless of any allegiance. This is nothing to do with partisanship. This has to do with doing the right thing. On the evening of June 23rd, 2020, I voted in the Democratic primary at the 12 Corners Brighton Elementary School. As I signed in, the poll watcher commented that my signature didn't match. I went to show ID to prove who I was and was told no ID was needed. I thought it was odd that nothing else was required, and frankly, I'm ashamed to admit that I forgot no ID was required in New York to vote. I never received any communication regarding my signature, and didn't think much of it until I voted early in the early morning on November 3rd, 2020 at the East Avenue Brighton Fire Hall. I was very tired and anxious about using writing instruments that had been used by many people, even though they were cleaning in between each voter. Stressed and tired, I signed my name in a rushed, jerky format, which in no way matched my signature. Remembering my experience voting in the Democratic primary, again, I asked if they would like ID. Even knowing there were no ID requirements, I was still off-put by this lack of verification. I thought surely, if there was no way my signature could be validated, there would be follow-up or concern. I can say with 100% certainty that either there was no signature verification, or if there was an issue with my signature, there was no follow-up. I did not understand or know the process that is used by Monroe County to verify signatures. As a concerned citizen, I contacted the Monroe County Board of Elections. This had nothing to do with any election fraud claims, and my call or actions were not promoted by any of this. Also, my call was prior to any of the hearings that ended up occurring nationwide. I have always been one that asks lots of questions. My interaction was completely upsetting, and I'm still astounded by what I perceived to be their lack of concern and almost combative demeanor with me. I first spoke with Karen and asked what the process is if a voter signature does not match. I was told if there was an issue with my signature, they would have sent me a cure letter right away. I never received a cure letter. I asked, "What if you do not receive a cure letter?" And she transferred me to the supervisor, Maureen. I asked Maureen about the signature verification process and why it did not appear to be used. She did not seem interested in listening or answering my question. Maureen went on saying, "Your signature could be whatever you want," and commented on how sometimes people don't always sign the same way. As I asked further questions, she went on with what I considered to be threatening and intimidating language, saying that I could be charged with a federal offense and that I was making a mockery of the election. I can assure you, nothing could be further than the truth. I was going to make an in-person appointment. However, after being threatened, I did not feel comfortable meeting. I am still struggling to understand why we would not want voter ID and signature matching in our elections. I will note, I believe there is still a registered voter listed at our address that has not lived there since at least 2004. With no ID or signature matching, what is there to prevent someone from voting in their name, or anyone else for that matter? Obviously, there appears to be an issue with the voter roll, or at least at my address. I have no idea if my experience was limited or systemic in the 2020 election in Monroe County, or perhaps statewide or nationally. Again, this has nothing to do with party affiliation or some preconceived side. We should all be wanting to have faith in the integrity of our voting system. If an everyday person like me is treated this way, it does make you stop and question, what is going on? Why is it a hostile interaction? Never in my wildest dreams would I have expected how abused I felt and the mental anguish from my interaction with them. Citizens should not feel threatened by their elected officials. Senator Brooke, I sincerely hope, as a woman, you find this as egregious as I do and hope you take this into consideration when working on improving our elections and protecting our rights. How are people to feel comfortable and encouraged to participate when they feel threatened. Also, I think an earlier speaker did mention that democracy will not continue when people suffer personal attacks. I thank you for your time.
Thank you both. Senator Brooke.
Thank you both again for, I know it can be nerve-wracking to speak up here, so we appreciate you taking the time. And for all of the folks who have testified today, I can't tell you how much I appreciate that here in Monroe County and the Rochester region, you take your civic engagement seriously, you take time out of your day to make sure that other senators around the state understand the needs of Monroe County, so thank you.
Thank you, Senator Rath.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you both for your comments and your perspective today. And you both did a wonderful job, you for sure did. And to your point that you made earlier, Jane, right?
Yes.
Okay. You said that the faith and the integrity in our voting system is critical and should not be infringed. And I absolutely agree with you. If there's an important takeaway, it's that we are fighting to improve and restore that faith and integrity in our election system. And the notes that I've taken to me turn into action items. And all of us were up here paying very close attention, and this is what we go back to Albany with, is the information that we are now armed with to improve our system. And there is so much that we have digested and heard over the past couple of days, and we'll continue to digest and hear about how our systems and our processes and our administration can be improved, from the incredible unfunded mandate on our counties, the cost that it is to conduct these elections, to the amazing work ethic and professionalism of our boards of elections, and how tirelessly and how hard they work to fulfill their responsibilities. And all of the challenges that we heard with regards to Ms. Cologne and yourself, we take to heart, and we will bring about that positive change. One thing that I heard—
I hope so.
We need to, and that's for your challenge and Ms. Cologne's challenge are not isolated incidents. And that means that we need to fix those, and we will. And I think that a lot of times there's a little misunderstanding of the operational challenges that our boards of elections have, and it's not through any fault of their own. They're trying as hard as they can, and New York needs to, I think, slow down sometimes the process and make sure that we consult with our boards of elections and include them in the process for election changes. So we're here to work for you, we're here to fight for you, and we will improve our elections administration in New York State.
Thank you, Senator Rath, and thank you both for your time and for your testimony. So that concludes the witness portion of the hearing. I did want to offer my colleagues the opportunity to give closing remarks as we move to end the hearing, and we'll start with Senator Brooke.
Thank you. Again, I just want to thank Senator Myrie. It's quite a trip to come from Brooklyn, and he has made not one but two stops upstate, and I think there are more to come. So on behalf of our community, thank you so much for making this a priority. Thank you again to those of you who have stuck it out who are still here. Kudos to you, and to everyone who's come to make their voice heard. You know, I think we have heard a lot today, some of it new, some of it repetitive, because we've heard a lot of the same things as you've gone across the state thinking about election reform. But I think we should all remember that at the end of the day, you know, as the daughter of an immigrant who, not unlike Ms. Cologne, worked very hard to get his citizenship to be able to vote, I take that right incredibly seriously. You know, my own ancestors who were here in the United States didn't have the right to vote, and folks fought very hard. And so we take our job very seriously to make sure that we are re-enfranchising folks and that we make voting as easy as possible. And I do think we need to again state that we have secure elections in New York State and in the United States of America, and we will continue to strengthen the election process and the democratic process. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Rath.
Thank you, Chairman Myrie, and thank you, Senator Brooke, for this very important discussion that we had here today. I think it's always very eye-opening when we are listening to the people in our communities and the perspective that they are providing to us on the challenges in the election administration. I really truly believe this is really not the time nor the place for partisan agendas or partisan politics. This is the time and the place for thoughtful and balanced solutions. And that's what we're going to fight to do as members of the Elections Committee. And to Chairman Myrie, I really appreciate you coming upstate, getting a taste of the culture, and you're always welcome. I appreciate our friendship and our collaboration. We work very well together in Albany. A lot of times we might not agree, but we're never disagreeable, and I appreciate that about this committee and the style that we conduct our business. And so for me, just like the other day, I took 6 pages of notes, and those notes turn into action items, and they turn into to-do list for me, and I think for all of us, as we collaborate on how we can fix these elections processes, collaborate with our boards of elections, and do the work that we need to do to make sure that no one has the experiences that we heard today, which are unfortunate, they're unnecessary, they're disrespectful, and they have to stop. So thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, and let me again reiterate my gratitude to Senator Brook and Senator Rath for granting me my upstate pass for the day. I am extremely grateful. I want to thank all the witnesses that took time to come here in person and to testify. Those who may not be used to this, it is a daunting thing to come before a Senate committee, and all of you did a really good job in your presentation, so thank you. I want to thank our staffs again for all of the excellent work that they did to put this together. Another huge shout out to our tech staff who have been holding us down throughout these statewide hearings. And to those who are viewing at home, we appreciate you as well. I would encourage anyone who was not able to testify in person today, please do submit written testimony. We are accepting that. We will be having another hearing in Westchester next week. So if you are a Westchester voter or stakeholder, please, we look forward to hearing from you in person and or in written testimony. And we will be having a hearing in Albany in September, September 21st, where we will hear a lot from boards of elections. The entire committee will be here, and where we will have an opportunity to ask more questions. It will be much more focused on the individuals charged with guarding our democracy. So again, thank you everyone for your time today, and I hope everyone stays safe and enjoys the rest of their week. Thank you very much.